Okay, hi guys, and sorry for keeping you guys waiting for quite some time. I had some last whispers concerning certain Osce stations. I hope you guys are doing very well today. So thank you for being patient. Those that have joined and waited, if you still have some friends that still are looking forward to this stream, please tell them that it has started. Hi to everyone. I'll constantly be looking down here because that's where my chat is on my phone. So hi everyone, and hope you're good. And so today we're going to be looking at pediatrics. So before I actually start, it's very important that you should note that even though some of these questions may not necessarily come, some may come in your exam, some may not, it's the concept that I want you to get from these live streams, how to approach these Osce exams, how to consider certain questions. And for those that are not just writing end of rotation, but those that are going to be writing end of year exams, it's even much more important for you guys, because the same revision is going to be working just even for your end of exam. So hi Angel, how are you doing? So don't forget to subscribe to the channel if you haven't, drop a like and drop a comment, show some support. So I hope you're ready, you get your pieces of papers and your pens, so let's go. So we begin with our station one. I added a whole lot more stations to this. So there are some stations that are going to be new, like brand new, you have never heard them before, and there are others that are not so new. So hi Penlop, hi Christabel. So station one, a six-year-old child presents with fever and neck rigidity. Lumbar puncture was done and showed WBC to be 3000, and more than 80% were polymorphonuclear cells. Glucose was 23 milligrams per deciliter, which is about 1.23 millimoles per liter. Then proteins was 500 milligrams per deciliter. Now, before I actually even go into this question, it is imperative to actually note that there are two different unit systems that you can actually be given. In terms of glucose, they may sometimes be giving you the values in milligrams per deciliter. Sometimes they may be giving you the value in millimoles per liter. So there's a conversion factor that you have to know. So the conversion factor is 18. So if you're changing milligrams per deciliter to millimoles per liter, you're pretty much going to be dividing that by a factor of 18. So if you're changing 23 to 1.28, you're going to say 23 divided by 18. Then for the milligrams per deciliter, if you're changing it to grams per liter, you're going to be dividing it by 100. So if you're changing 500 milligrams per deciliter to grams per liter, you divide that by 100. So it means that someone with a protein of 500 would mean that they have 5 grams. And remember that the normal parameters that we have of CSF, number one, our blood glucose is supposed to be 2/3 to 1/2 of the plasma glucose. Number two, the protein is supposed to be somewhere around 0.2 to 0.4 grams per liter. Not milligrams per liter, but grams per liter. So it means that if you're changing that, you would have to multiply by 100. So it'd be about 20 to 40 milligrams per deciliter if you're changing it to milligrams per deciliter. Then our WBCs are supposed to be less than 5 cells per high power field. RBCs, they should be less than 10 cells per high power field. So as we can see in this result here, you get a CSF result where there's a lot of WBCs. There's a lot of glucose, there's a lot of protein inside there, or rather the glucose is low, not even a lot, the glucose is low. So most likely these are the microorganism that's present in this child. And remember, this child presented with fever and a neck pain, so it's most likely that this child has a meningitis of some sort. So this is obviously a bacterial meningitis, an acute bacterial meningitis if you want to be exact. Although I'm not given the time period of this child. So they have a high white blood cell count. So 3000 is very high. And predominantly this is neutrophil. So that's also going to be keying you. And it should be giving you some perspective that this could be bacterial. They have a low glucose and they have a high protein. Now, what other two investigations are you going to order? You're going to be ordering for a blood culture. You're going to to be ordering for a full blood count in this child. Then the two possible organisms most commonly that will cause meningitis are either your Streptococcus pneumoniae or your Neisseria meningitidis. Okay, those are the two. And remember that these can also have the propensity to cause these upper respiratory tract airway pathologies as well as lower respiratory tract pathologies. And how are we going to manage this child? So the management is going to be lying pretty much on providing supportive care. So pretty much giving this child monitoring the vitals, fluid restriction. Why are we restricting fluids in a child that has meningitis? Remember that there is a risk of a complication that is known as a syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion, or SIAD in short. Now, this syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion, where someone secretes a lot of ADH, and because they've secreted a lot of ADH, they retain the water, they retain sodium. So now if you're loading this child with more fluids, it means that this child may go into fluid overload, and that's another problem that you're going to be creating in this child. In addition to this, you cover them on antibiotics. Pretty much these microorganisms respond to either your third generation cephalosporins, or they're going to be responding to your penicillins. So either your ceftriaxone. Remember that if this child was a neonate, we want to avoid generally ceftriaxone in neonates because it has the propensity of displacing bilirubin from its binding place to albumin. So it can actually cause kinicteris. So we want to use cefotaxime instead in the neonates. But this child is 6 years old, so ceftriaxone can work. Then you should also cover them on steroids like dexamethasone to actually taper down the reaction. And this has actually been shown to reduce the complications that are going to be associated with meningitis. So I hope you have a good understanding of this question. Now, moving on to the next question. It's never a pediatric exam if we don't have a station on this picture that I'm showing you. And if you have any questions, please feel free to type them in the chat. There may be some delay because of the way the stream works. There may be some delay in me getting your question and reading it out from the chat box because of, I think, my broadcast is much faster than the one that you're watching. Okay. So, hi, Luendo. I hope you're well. So, here's station two. A child was born to a 38-year-old mother, and the image is shown on the right. I see someone has asked the question. So if we said TB meningitis instead of acute meningitis, would we still be correct? No. The reason why we are going for acute meningitis instead of TB, it's because remember that in TB meningitis, so if I get back to this, if we look at the CSF result here, predominantly 80% of them are polymorphonuclear cells, which are pretty much your neutrophils. Remember that the neutrophils are going to be highest concentration in bacterial type of meningitis. The lymphocytes and the monocytes are the ones that you're going to be expecting in patients that have chronic type of TB, which is, or chronic TB meningitis. I hope that answers your question. So coming back to this station, a child was born to a 38-year-old mother, and the image is shown on the right. Mention important features you notice. What is your diagnosis? Mention one risk factor for this condition. Mention any three other associated problems. Now, if we look at this child very, very well here on the right of the screen, let me just get out my pointer. We have a child that has... You can see that these eyes are slightly slanted up. Not really the characteristic upslanting of the palpebral fissures, but there is some slanting that's there. If we actually zoom into this picture, so let me just zoom into this picture, we can see that even there are some epicanthal folds that you can see here, a flat nasal bridge. The tongue appears huge, so it's like sticking out from the mouth. You call this as a macroglossia. And of course, the mouth appears small, the child's face appears round. And if you even notice here, even in the iris, it's like someone is painting over the iris. So they have this brush border kind of appearance on the iris. So this is, of course, your features are going to be your upslanting palpebral fissures. You're going to be having your flat nasal bridge. You have your microstomia. You have your macroglossia, and you have your round face. So this is consistent with Down syndrome. So you can write Down syndrome, you can write trisomy 21, whatever you want to write. The huge risk factor is increasing maternal age. All mothers that are above the age of 35, the higher the years, the more you are at risk of actually giving birth to a child that has Down syndrome. And remember that the majority of the cases of Down syndrome are going to be due to your non-meiotic, or your meiotic non-disjunction rather, where the chromosomes fail to separate into individual chromosomes in the genes, such that one of them will be empty, the other one will have like an extra chromosome, such that when they come together, when the oocyte and the spermatozoa come together to form a zygote, you have three chromosomes instead of two at position 21. And another risk factor that can actually exist for this condition is obviously if the mother has had a previous child that has Down syndrome, that's already also a risk factor of having a child with Down syndrome again. Then mention any three associated problems. So these people tend to come in with conductive hearing loss. So it's imperative that this child actually gets another variant to this question that they may ask you, is that what tests would you do to assess this child as they grow? So it would be hearing test, because these associated hearing losses. The other thing that these children are usually associated with is hypothyroidism. So it's very important that you do your T3, T4, your TSH on this child. They may also have some congenital heart disease, so you screen for that. They may have your atrial septal defects, they may have your ventricular septal defects, they may have total absence of the septum. They may have things like patent ductus atriosum, or even a tetralogy of Fallot, or even a mitral valve prolapse. Then they may also have learning disabilities. We do not want to call them learning disability. Do not want to call them mental retardation. We want to refer to it as learning disabilities. Then they may also have duodenal atresia, even Hirschsprung's disease. Now here's an alternate. Here are alternate images that have been shown in different Osce stations that you should look out for. All these are Down syndrome images. So I just put this in this presentation. There are some stations where I realize that the same question is being asked but with different images. So just keep a lookout for this. You may get this in your exam. You may get this in your exam. You may get this in your exam. They're all talking about Down syndrome. The key thing is knowing the principle. Now we move on to station three. This is a 1 year old previously healthy boy presented with coryza, cough, respiratory distress, and poor feeding. On examination, the child has labored breathing, intercostal recessions, fine inspiratory crepitations, and wheezing. Give possible diseases that can cause these features. Mention an investigation that can confirm your diagnosis. If your diagnosis is bronchiolitis, what is the most likely pathogen? What is your treatment? Okay, so here's the x-ray of the child. It rather seems like you have this ground glass kind of appearance that is seen in this x-ray. Now what I mean by a ground glass appearance, it's not really a consolidation. It's not solid enough for you to not see through the lungs, but you can see that there's a process. There is even some interstitial infiltrates that you can see in the lungs of this child. So this is most consistent with a disease that's known as hyaline membrane disease, or respiratory respiratory distress syndrome. So it could be that this child has a viral bronchiolitis. It could be that this child has a foreign body. It could be that this child has a pneumonia. Even your hyaline membrane disease can give you such a similar presentation. But it's most likely that this child has a bronchiolitis that presenting with. Now there are some people that could suggest that, what about asthma? Now with asthma, this children would have pretty much a history of eczema in the family, or a history of eczema in themselves, which is dermatitis. They could also have this chronicity, and also the age. Asthma, making a diagnosis of asthma at 1 year would be a very huge stretch, unless if maybe there's a family history or positive things that are suggestive of this child having asthma. So I really wouldn't put that out there as one of the main things, but viral bronchiolitis, I would agree. So the things that you want to do is, you want to get a blood culture, you want to get a full blood count, you want to get some viral studies. So you want to get a nasopharyngeal aspirate and actually send that for your PCR. And of course, your main causative agent that's going to be there is pretty much your respiratory syncytial virus, RSV. Remember in your exams, please, and I want to stress this, do not use abbreviations. Make sure that you write things in full. Do not write in any abbreviations. Then how are we going to manage this child? Remember that most of the management in bronchiolitis is pretty much going to be hanging on your symptomatic management. So we want to rehydrate the child. Remember, any patient that has an increase in respiratory rate, any patient that has tachypnea is losing fluid in their body. It means that if this child's respiratory rate is increased, they're going to be expiring and losing fluid, because every time you breathe out, there is some mist that is coming out from your lungs. So you want to give them IV fluids. You can even push in an energy tube if they're not really feeding so well. In this case, this child has been shown to poorly feed, so you can try and push in an energy tube. Then, of course, ensure that the oxygen saturation is greater than 92%. Always. So you should give your oxygen. Then you may or you may not require some gentle suctioning, because they also have some coryza illnesses. So suctioning of the nasal passages, some people say that this causes damage and this actually worsens the conditions. There are some physicians who are actually pro for this. But a much better idea would be using your nasal saline drops. Just a few drops of nasal saline and may help clear up the mucus that is retained in this child. And of course, if you are now suspecting that this child could have a form of asthma, if you're stretching it very far, you may use a bronchodilator. Strictly speaking, in strict essence, we sometimes do use bronchodilators, we sometimes don't. But in most patients that I've noticed that come in with bronchiolitis, regardless of whether it's bronchiolitis or not, we want to actually use your bronchodilators. If they respond, well and good. If they don't, then try something else. We may also decide to add epinephrine, because it also causes a form of a bronchodilatation. Now, remember that if you're treating, strictly speaking, viral bronchiolitis, in terms of academic purposes, antibiotics are not indicated. Even the practice that we are doing as doctors of adding antibiotics to every single patient that's admitted to the hospital for no apparent reason, it's actually not really a correct practice. Antibiotics, in a strict sense, are not indicated for a child that has viral bronchiolitis. Then, of course, you should also have some chest physiotherapy, so involve the physio guys. Now, moving on to another station, it's also not possible for you to get an exam without this kind of station. So a two-year-old patient comes to Levimwanawasa University Teaching Hospital with a history of passing dark colored urine, fever, yellowing of the eyes for 2 days. On admission, she is pale. Take note, she is pale. Jaundiced with a temperature of 38.8. Results are shown. So this was, I suppose, microscopy. Then this was the urine. What is the diagnosis? What complication has occurred? What are the possible complications? What other investigations would you do? What is the drug of choice? Now, it's never really a station, an Osce station, if you don't get a malaria case. You can always expect malaria to come on your Osce stations. Maybe, unless if it's one of those things where the lecturer just woke up and chose not to include any malaria stations, but you should expect, you should expect some malaria cases to actually show up on your Osce exam. So, obviously, this is severe malaria. Why am I saying this is severe malaria? Number one, this child is passing dark urine. The reason why they are passing dark urine is because of what is known as your hemoglobinuria. They are passing hemoglobin into their urine. Hemoglobin will change the color. You remember that two things that can change the color of urine and darken it. Hemoglobin is one thing that can change the urine and darken it. The other thing is conjugated bilirubin. Conjugated bilirubin in the urine will make the urine dark. Similar thing that we see in cases of infants or people that have obstructive jaundice. So the other reason is this child has jaundice. I know some people may argue and say that no, jaundice is actually not a feature of severe malaria and all that. If you really want to carry on the argument, I'll send you a link or post you a link to go on Medscape and actually have a look at the complications or the features of severe malaria. In pediatrics, actually, jaundice is actually considered as a feature of severe malaria. In adults, it's not considered as a feature of severe malaria. Then, of course, she's pale, meaning that there is some anemia to some sort that this two-year-old is presenting with. So the complication that has arisen here is your black hemoglobinuria. Then what are some of the other complications? You can think of things like coming from head to toe. Whenever they ask you about clinical features, even about Down syndrome, you should envision things from head to toe. What could be the CNS complications that a person can come in with? They could have, okay, cerebral malaria if they have two or more generalized tonic-clonic convulsions in 24 hours attributed to no other cause but malaria, or they have an unarousable state which is attributed to not any other cause but malaria, then you consider that as the bracket of falling under cerebral malaria. Then they may have pulmonary edema, they may have acidosis, your metabolic acidosis, that's your pH less than 7.25. they may have hypoglycemia in children, that's a blood sugar that's less than 2.2. they may have a disseminated intravascular coagulation. They may have your algid malaria, that's they come in shock. And please make sure that you always read through the question. People have the tendency of repeating and giving back what has already been given you in the question. They have already told you that this person is pale. Then you go ahead and say anemia as the other possible complications. So read the question and weigh whatever has been given to you, and do not repeat back to the examiner. Then, of course, what are the investigations would you do? So you'll do your random blood sugar. You would do your full blood count and your differentials, because remember, with severe malaria, there is also associated gram-negative organisms, which is why most of the times when we're treating children with severe malaria, we tend to add an antibiotic to it. So you do an FBC as well. You're going to also do your urea, electrolytes, and creatinine, because this child already has black water fever and you want to rule out any acute kidney injury, which is also a feature of severe malaria. Then we also want to do our arterial blood gases to actually show the metabolic acidosis. Then what is the drug of choice? So in this case, we're going to be giving a tesonate. Now, there is a video that I released on the previous pediatric bazooka episodes, and where I talked about the dosage of a tesonate in actually it was in the theory questions, the dosage of a tesonate. Again, there is a bit of some debate over there where they say the younger children, those that are less than the age of 3, you should give a much higher dose, even as high as 3 milligrams per kg. And then in the individuals that are older, that's where you can give the 2.5. others even go ahead and give a range between 2.4 to about 3 milligrams per kg. So there is that variation that is also there, but go exactly with what the lecturer has told you. If they've told you that, okay, give 3 milligrams per kg of a tesonate, please stick to that. But in terms of practice, usually most of the things are standardized at 2.4, even that's what Medscape usually standardizes them. But regardless, the drug of choice that you're going to be giving is a tesonate. Here's another station, station 5. A child was admitted to the emergency department in the picture shown. Describe the picture. What is the diagnosis? What investigation will you order? What is the acute management in the case? What is the chronic management in this case? Mention some complications of this disease. Now, before I actually go any further, there's something that's very important that I forgot to mention, because I'll mention the important site links. This is one way in which they can ask you the question. Another way is they could bring you a slide with these ring forms that you can actually see of these malaria parasites. So they may sometimes bring you the slide, they may sometimes bring you the urine sample itself, or they may just sometimes give you a clinical scenario where someone comes in maybe from Chongwe and they are unconscious, or they come in from outside the outskirts of Lusaka and they come in and they were seizing, whatever it may be. Just know, if they're outside Lusaka and they're probably presenting to you with features of malaria, then it's most likely malaria. So yeah, let's get back to this question here. So now, here you get a child that presents to the emergency department and they have swelling of the feet, they have swelling of the limbs. As you can see, what's shown there. So describe what is seen in the picture. As we can see here, they have a swollen hand and they have the swollen feet. Okay? They have swollen hands and swollen feet. Now you think to yourself, what condition can present to me with the swollen hands and swollen feet? This is most likely the only thing that comes to mind is your hand and foot syndrome, your acute dactylitis. So most likely this patient is a sickle cell patient. Now, I want you to be able to distinguish between three things. I want you to be able to distinguish between your sickle cell disease, your sickle cell anemia, and I also want you to be able to distinguish between your sickle cell trait. It's very important you distinguish between these three things: sickle cell trait, sickle cell disease, sickle cell anemia. Now, when I talk about sickle cell trait, remember that the problem here is that an individual has a defect in their hemoglobin gene. So they have an HBS. So they have a hemoglobin gene, one defective hemoglobin gene. So if they only carry that defective hemoglobin gene with a normal adult hemoglobin, then you call that as a carrier. These may not necessarily have symptoms, but they do. They can actually also present you with symptoms under specific conditions. Things like when they go into immense stress. What do I mean by immense stress? For example, if they're exposed to hypoxia, then they're pretty much going to be presenting in this manner. The second thing is your sickle cell disease. Now, with sickle cell disease here, you're going to be having pretty much two things happening. You have an abnormal sickle cell gene, and you have another abnormal hemoglobin, but not necessarily your sickle cell hemoglobin. For example, it could be hemoglobin C. So if you have a combination of HBS and HBC, you call that a sickle cell disease. Now, sickle cell anemia is where you have now two sickle cell genes. So you have HBS, HBS. So that's the difference. That's a major difference between sickle cell trait, sickle cell disease, sickle cell anemia. If you want an easy way to remember, just this could, sickle cell trait, you can think it as the mildest form of the disease. Sickle cell disease as an intermediate. Sickle cell anemia itself as the worst presentation of the disease. So the investigations that we can actually order, HB electrophoresis. We can also have a peripheral smear. We can also have an FPC or a differential count. Now, on your HB electrophoresis, it's just pretty much chromatography. If you have actually done chromatography in chemistry or wherever you did it in biology, wherever, remember that chromatography is pretty much separating substances using a solvent based on their different solubilities. For example, you get a dye, a mixture of a dye, they'll separate according to the different solubilities on that filtration paper. Now, with the HB electrophoresis, you're pretty much separating now the different types of hemoglobin across an electric field. So here they'll give you the percentages. Okay, this is how much HBS this child has. This is how much HbA. This is how much the fetal hemoglobin that this person has. So I hope that makes sense. And then peripheral smear, I'll show you some peripheral smears and how different ways they can ask you about sickle cell can come in your exams. Then what is the acute management in this case? So pretty much we want to rehydrate this child. We want to give them analgesia because this is painful. This presentation, it's a vaso-occlusive crisis. So now someone is asking, why not heart failure? The reason why we're not saying heart failure in this case, remember that this swelling here, in the limbs, all right, if you notice here the digits are swollen, it's very rare that you see swollen digits in this fashion in heart failure. Very rare. Of course, heart failure can be a differential that you want to entertain, because we're not saying sickle cell patients cannot have heart failure, but it is much more common to present with your sickle cell dactylitis, acute hand and foot syndrome, rather than heart failure. Also looking at the age of the child, heart failure in children not so common unless if it's associated with some other pathologies. I hope that answers your question. But of course, heart failure, we should keep that in mind. If they ask for a differential, that could be a differential for this. Then what is the chronic management in this case? So we want to avoid any stress, so dehydration, cold, so keep the child warm, rehydrate them. We want to cover them on some prophylactic drugs like penicillins. Remember that people that have sickle cell are sometimes exposed to having been infected with encapsulated organisms. So want to give them your penicillin prophylaxis. If they are allergic to penicillins, then an alternative erythromycin can be used. Now, we also want to vaccinate these children against pneumococcus, want to vaccinate them against Haemophilus influenza, want to vaccinate them against meningococcal infection. Now, the reason why we want to vaccinate them against these three things is because they're encapsulated organisms and they can cause illness in these people with sickle cell. And they have been shown to be much more virulent in patients that have sickle cell because of the decrease in the complement factors, the involvement of the spleen in sickle cell patients. Now, mention some complications. Again, guys, you can just simply go from head to toe. CNS complications. This person could have a stroke. This person could have a retinal hemorrhage. This person could have retinal detachment. This person could have a short stature in terms of the musculoskeletal system. In the cardiovascular system, they could have heart failure. They could have arrhythmias. In your respiratory system, they could have your acute chest syndrome. Now, heart failure in sickle cell patients, actually, they have a special type of heart failure that is known as a copulmonale. Remember that copulmonale is a right-sided kind of heart failure that is as a result of a pulmonary pathology. Now, what is the problem here in patients that have sickle cell? So I'm about to explain something that is very, very important. Number one, these people are going to be having their red blood cells having a shorter lifespan. So they get hemolyzed much quicker. The normal lifespan of red blood cells is roughly about 100 to 120 days. But in someone with sickle cell, it's greatly reduced. So it means that at every time, the turnover is much, much faster. So there's going to be some free hemoglobin that's going to be released in the body. And remember that hemoglobin is quite toxic. It can't just be allowed to roam around freely in the body. So it has to bind to something. So usually the hemoglobin is going to bind to nitric oxide, okay? So this nitric oxide, or which is the other name for nitric oxide, is referred to as endothelial-derived relaxation factor. So it relaxes the endothelium. It causes vasodilatation. It's very important in the lungs. So patients that have, especially in African individuals, Africans already have a form of nitric oxide deficiency. If you actually read into the researches, Africans have lower levels of nitric oxide. So if already you have this hemoglobin that's binding to the little nitric oxide that is there, you use up all the nitric oxide. So there will be a further nitric oxide deficiency. So if this nitric oxide is not present, it would mean that now the vessels are going to be constricted. So these patients are going to be having pulmonary hypertension. The vessels in the lungs will be constricted. They have pulmonary hypertension. This is known as the hyperhemolytic paradigm, okay, or the hemolytic paradigm, which is pretty much the hemoglobin using up the nitric oxide. So because of this pulmonary hypertension, they can actually tip into heart failure. So they may also have renal dysfunction. They may have cognitive problems. Okay, someone is saying, what's the name of the nitric oxide? So the name of nitric oxide is endothelial-derived relaxation factor. So endothelial-derived relaxation factor. That's the other name for nitric oxide. It's known as the hyperhemolytic paradigm, especially in sickle cell patients. So we move again. Here's another way that they can trap you. Well, here's another way that they can get you. You see such a thing, and you may not necessarily get the same stations. I'll keep emphasizing this. You may not get the same stations. The principle here is get what I am explaining and how to think through the questions. So here's a slide that is given here. Identify two abnormalities in the peripheral smear. What is the diagnosis? Give four clinical features of this condition. What is the inheritance pattern? Okay. So here's the answer. So as we can see on this slide, we can see these sickle-shaped red blood cells. Yeah, that's sickle-shaped. And then you can see that there are some red blood cells which have a very dark center, a surrounding halo, and a darker area that's surrounding in the periphery. So these are referred to as codocytes, or you can refer to them as target cells. Okay, so you're seeing sickle-shaped red blood cells here. You're seeing target cells. In some patients, you may sometimes, if you look very closely in some slides, not on this one though, you may sometimes see some basophilic remnants in the cytoplasm of these red blood cells, some bluish bodies that you can see inside the red blood cells. You call those blue bodies as your Howell Jolly bodies. Howell as in H-O-W-E-L-L. Howell Jolly as in J-O-L-L-Y. Howell Jolly bodies. Now, these Howell Jolly bodies are pretty much going to be indicative that the person functionally is asplenic. So it functionally, the spleen isn't really doing its job. Hi Rajab, I hope you are doing well. So I hope you understand what the Howell Jolly bodies are. So the diagnosis here will be obviously your sickle cell anemia. So they can present you in one of the crises. So they can present you as a sequestration crisis where they have abdominal distension, they may have abdominal pain. It may actually mimic an acute abdomen. Or they may come in shortness of breath, tachycardic, they may be in pallor, they may be fatigued, they may even come in shock or circulatory collapse. This is a typical history where they give you a child that comes in distended abdomen, they're in shock, and they've had recurrent episodes of being admitted to the hospital for whatever reason, think that this could be a splenic sequestration, a sequestrative crisis. It not only just happens in the spleen, but it can also happen in the liver. The other thing that can be seen is hyperhemolytic crisis. Now, this hyperhemolytic crisis, you're going to be having pallor, you're going to be having fatigue, you're going to be having tachycardia, even jaundice. Okay, so they're hemolyzing their red blood cells at a much faster rate. Then they may also have an anaplastic crisis. Now, in a anaplastic crisis here, if you're reading the newer literature, if you're reading the old books that have been published, I don't know when, they're pretty much going to be telling you that the anaplastic crisis is going to be caused by a virus which is known as your parvovirus B19. But recently, what was discovered is that this virus actually only affects the erythroid progenitor cells. So it was actually reclassified, and it's now going to be referred to as your erythrovirus B19. That's the newer name, the erythrovirus B19. So it affects the progenitor cells and causes your aplastic kind of anemia. Then they may also have a vaso-occlusive crisis, which can present as a dactylitis, it can present as an acute chest syndrome, it can present as an acute abdomen, it can even present as infarction. Now, there's a very, very interesting question that someone asked me about 3 weeks ago, and I want to pose the question in your mind and actually keep this in your mind. You can write it down somewhere, Google some answers, then come back and then answer or comment in the video after I post the stream later on. What's the difference between acute chest syndrome and a pneumonia? How would you differentiate between acute chest syndrome and pneumonia? Clinically, how would you differentiate between those two? I want you to read up on that. It's a very interesting thing to actually look up. Then they may also present to you with acute abdomen, like I said, even your infarction. The inheritance pattern of this is autosomal recessive, meaning that for an individual to actually have the condition, they have to inherit both defective genes from the mother as well as from the father. So it's actually a nice way to actually do a DNA test. If one person is a carrier and another person is normal and they have a sickle cell child, then there is a discrepancy there. Because it's not possible to have someone who's a carrier, someone who's normal, having a sickle cell child. So unless there's something going on. So here's station 7. Study the image and answer the subsequent questions. They've even answered the first one for you. I wish the OSCE exam can be like this, where they even give you your answer before you even answer the question. So what equipment is shown above? What are the indications for the use of the equipment? What mechanisms does it use? Mention one contraindication for its use. What precautions are you going to take when using the equipment? And what are the complications? Someone missed the question. Which question are you talking about? The sickle shaped question? The sickle cell question is just pretty much your sickle cell case, your features of your sickle shaped red blood cells, your target cells, sickle cell anemia, and of course the clinical features are going to be your crisis, your sequestrative crisis, hyperhemolytic, your aplastic crisis, your vaso-occlusive crisis, and of course autosomal recessive inheritance pattern. So I hope it's just sickle cell. We'll come over sickle cell again later on in this same presentation. So what equipment is shown above? What are the indications of the use of the equipment? What mechanism does it use? Mention one contraindication. What precautions are you going to take when using the equipment? And what are the complications? I realized the question that you meant is difference between acute chest syndrome and pneumonia. Pneumonia, clinically, how you differentiate between those two? Acute chest syndrome and pneumonia. Sorry, I didn't get what you were meaning by repeating the question. Sorry. So obviously this is phototherapy, okay? So we do phototherapy for children that have unconjugated. This is the key word. Whether you're in fifth year, whether you're in seventh year, unconjugated is the key word. You can't just say jaundice and then expect to get 100%. No. So So you can actually come out from the an Osce station having written everything, but yet you still fail. Why is this so? It's how you answer. So if you say, if you just say hyperbilirubinemia, on a good day, if it's 2 marks, I'll give you 0.5. If you just say jaundice or neonatal jaundice, on a good day, I'll give you 0.5 still. So you have to specify that your unconjugated hyperbilirubinemia, unconjugated jaundice, because we don't just do thought phototherapy for any child. We don't do phototherapy for conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. So how this phototherapy machine works is that it uses blue light. As you can see here, this is blue. So blue light has a wavelength of about 420 to about 460, I think that's supposed to be nanometers. And it's going to be working by three things. Number one, photooxidation. So it changes these compounds. You remember bilirubin is water insoluble. So you have to make it more water soluble. The unconjugated one is water insoluble. So you have to make it more water soluble so it can be excreted in the urine. So it can undergo photooxidation, where it actually changes to much more soluble compounds like lumirubin. Lumirubin is much more water soluble than unconjugated bilirubin. Then you may sometimes go in this photoisomerization, where you change them to the other enantiomers. If you remember the enantiomers or the isomers back from your organic chemistry, these different isomers have different solubilities. Then of course you can also change the structure. You can perform structural isomerization. So those are the three mechanisms to which this machine works: photooxidation, photoisomeration, structural isomerization. So one contraindication, like I already mentioned, conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. If you take a child that has conjugated hyperbilirubinemia for phototherapy, they'll develop a complication that's known as a bronze baby syndrome. Their skin will appear a bronze in color. So the precautions that you want to take for this child that's on phototherapy, you want to make sure that you regularly check your RBS, because there's a high risk of hypoglycemia. There's a high risk of this child going into hypoglycemia. So encourage the mother to continue breastfeeding this child. Also, there's a risk of dehydration with this, even diarrhea as a result of the phototherapy. And of course, you want to maintain the room temperature at about 30 degrees, because you don't want this child to overheat with hyperthermia, because the skin of an infant is not the same as your skin. It hasn't yet adapted and pretty much well developed to maintain the changes in temperature. You also want to cover the eyes, you want to cover the genitalia, and keep the phototherapy machine at a distance of about 20 to 45 cents, kind of like a ruler distance, which is like this kind of distance. So the complications are going to be things like diarrhea. They're going to be things like your dehydration. You may have bronze baby syndrome. You may have hyperthermia. You may have some retinal damage. You may have your potential genetic damage. But of course, that hasn't been seen at all in our cases here. Here's an alternate image that they can bring you on your Osce station. So they may sometimes bring you this image. They may sometimes bring you this image here. Sometimes they may just not even put the baby there. They just bring you a phototherapy machine, which is off. So keep that in mind, and keep these alternate images in mind, so that when they change the image or even change the question, you can still use the principle to answer those questions. Station 8, study the image shown. What is shown in the picture above? What are the indications of its use? What are the types of this instrument? List 4 drugs used with this instrument. I know most of you have seen this question, but the questions are actually different. So if you see a part C here, part C is it's a fresh question that's added to this. So this is obviously a nebulizer. Now, we use nebulizers in asthma. We use nebulizers in pneumonias. We use nebulizers in cystic fibrosis. We use nebulizers in bronchiectasis. We use nebulizers in atelectasis. We use nebulizers in bronchospasms, even in COPDs. We can just write everything. You can go to town with indications if they don't limit you by number. Now, the types of nebulizers, there are 3 main types of nebulizers. So there is the jet type, there's the ultrasonic type, and there's the mesh. Someone is saying, isn't it a cake mixer? No, it's not. So there is the jet type, there's the ultrasonic type, and there's a mesh. So the jet type is going to be using, it's going to be using compressed gas. So it uses air to force the drugs and create an aerosol. So it uses air. That's known as a jet nebulizer. Then you have an ultrasonic nebulizer here. This is what is going to be making the aerosol using sound, using high frequency vibrations. Now, the particles that you're going to be making, or the particles of the same aerosol that you'll be making, are much larger than those that we use with the jet type of a nebulizer. Then the third type is a mesh, where you actually have to use liquid, and the liquid passes through the fine mesh and then it forms the aerosol. So these are the three types of nebulizers. Keep this in mind: your jet, your ultrasonic, and your mesh. Then the four drugs that we can use with this instrument, we can use beta 2 agonists such as salbutamol and corticosteroids such as triamcinolone, fluticasone, budesonide, and even flunisolide. We can also use your ipratropium. We can also use your adrenaline. So how do you differentiate between conjugated and unconjugated bilirubin on presentation? So remember that conjugated bilirubin has characteristic features. This is more or less your obstructive jaundice. So you have those four characteristics. If it's a very young child, the only thing that you may notice is the jaundice will be dark. So they'll have dark jaundice in conjugated bilirubinemia, hyperbilirubinemia. The second thing is that the urine will be dark because of the conjugated bilirubin that will be in the urine. So the urine is the key. The stool will also be pale. And if it's in an older child, they may even have itchiness if they have jaundice in an older child. So that's how you're pretty much going to be distinguishing between your conjugated versus unconjugated. And the trick is this: also, when you do your labs, not just clinically, when you do your labs, there's what we call, I know you guys are used to saying, when you throw around the word liver function tests, you say, no, we order for liver function tests, then you just say AST, ALT. No, those are not liver function tests. So when you order for liver function tests, one of the liver function tests that we do is serum bilirubin. Now, serum bilirubin is pretty much you can measure our conjugated bilirubin. Then we also look at our total bilirubin. So you get a ratio. So you say the conjugated bilirubin divided by your total bilirubin, multiply that by 100. If the value that you get is greater than 20%, then it is most likely that this person has conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. I hope you got that right. Let me just repeat. You get your conjugated bilirubin divided by your total bilirubin, multiply that by 100. If the value that you get is greater than 20%, then it's most likely this person has conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. If it's less than that, it's unconjugated. That's another way in which you can tell. I hope that answers your question. So here comes the videos, okay? The expect videos. Okay, for your Osce stations, expect videos. So here comes a video that I want to play for you, and I want you to pay very close attention to this video, okay? So I'm going to mute the video just in case there's any talking in the background. So I'll just mute the video. And I just want you to pay very much close attention to this video. Okay, so that's the video. I know some of you have never seen this at all in your life, and you have no idea what is going on. And some people will learn it even as a new thing in the exam. So watch the video. I'll play it again so that you can watch the video. I'll play it one more time so that you can watch the video. Okay? Pay close attention. Okay, so that's the video. I hope you keep that in mind. So let's go to the questions now. Describe what is shown in the video. What is your diagnosis? What other clinical features would be present? What investigations would you order? How would you manage? Okay, so let me describe the video now before I get the answer, so that I can give you time to think about it and to contemplate. I'll be playing the video and now I'll be talking as I am playing the video. So notice the leg here, the moving of the leg, the moving of the hand, the moving of the fingers there. Notice that. You see how these legs are just moving like that? This is moving like that. This is also moving like that. Okay. Now watch video two. How the child is walking. Okay. They're moving their hands. Okay. Okay. They're moving their feet. Okay. I'm glad someone actually pointed it out in the chat just now. Namakao. Thank you very much. So This is chorea, okay? So you can see that there's some clumsiness of the hand. There is uncoordinated, involuntary, purposeless, non-repetitive movements of the hands. That's what we see in the video. Even of the hand, not just the hands, but the hands and the feet. So this is in rheumatic fever. Now, what are the symptoms can you see? So in a patient like this that has chorea, you can see another thing that's known as a chameleon tongue or a darting tongue. You pretty much tell them to protrude their tongue. When they protrude their tongue, it will keep flicking in and out, in and out, in and out, like a chameleon. Another thing is what's known as a milkmaid's grip. So a milkmaid, you know, those bottles of milk are very slippery. Okay, very, very slippery. So if you ask the child to grip your hands or to grip your fingers, their grip isn't so good, such that you can easily pull out from the grip. So it's known as a milkmaid's hands. Another thing is known as a pronator sign, where you ask them to put their arms above their head. And once they put their arms above their head, then their forearms are going to pronate. So that's what is known as a pronator sign. Those are the other things that may accompany a child that has Sydenham's chorea. So that child here, they had Sydenham's chorea. It's most likely that the child has rheumatic fever. So what investigations would you order? So you want to order your antistreptolysin otitis, because you first have to prove that this child has had, or they may even have a history of sore throats. Then you're going to be doing your ESR, your C-reactive protein, your full blood count. Remember that your acute phase reactants, your ESR, C-reactive protein may be raised. Then you may also order for some other antibodies, like anti-DNA's antibodies, anti-hyaluronidase antibodies that may also be raised. Remember, your Jones criteria is what you're going to be using for the diagnosis. There are some major criteria that are used. So things like carditis, things like your polymigratory arthritis. You may also have things like your Sydenham's chorea. You may also have your subcutaneous nodule. Those are like the major criteria. The minor criteria are pretty much things like your increase in ESR, your increase in CRP, your increase in your PR interval on your ECG, and a fever. Then, of course, if they have a proven history of a sore throat or positive titers for antistreptolysin or antibodies, plus two majors, one minor, or all the majors, or three majors, or you can make a diagnosis of rheumatic fever. Now, the difference between rheumatic fever and rheumatic heart disease is this. Because someone on the stream is going to say, oh no, this is rheumatic heart disease. No. The difference is this. Rheumatic heart disease is where you have complications affecting the heart. Rheumatic heart disease is a sequel of rheumatic fever. Okay? It's an end result of rheumatic fever. So first, someone will first have to get rheumatic fever. Then if they now present you with these cardiac manifestations or heart problems, then you call that as rheumatic heart disease. They haven't mentioned any of that here, so there's no reason why you should say rheumatic heart disease here. It's rheumatic fever. So how do we manage patients that have this Sydenham's chorea and rheumatic fever? So we pretty much want to reduce the stress, because the more they are stressed emotionally, physically, the more apparent the clumsiness is going to be. You want to cover them on benzathine, penicillins, or erythromycin if they are allergic, prophylaxis. For the chorea itself, if it's severe such that it disturbs them, you can give them phenobarbital, you can give them haloperidol, you may give them clopromazine, you may also give them diazepam. Steroids are also needed. Anti-inflammatory drugs, NSAIDs, and all those friends, not indicated in this case. They're not indicated. So we move. Station 10, what are the equipment above called? How is the patient supposed to use the above equipment? So I'm sure most of you have seen this before. So this is a spacer. So this thing, sometimes they can just bring you this here. Okay, this just increases the surface area or the volume of the aerosol that is distributed from this, this inhaler. Then, of course, this is an inhaler. So sometimes they can just bring you the inhaler itself. Sometimes they can just bring you the spacer itself. So this is known as a spacer. It's connected to a face mask. So how are you going to be using this? So pretty much the child has to, or the adult, has to shake the canister about 3 to 4 times. We remove the cap. So there's a cap. I wish I had the inhaler that I had, but I've shown you how to use this. So you remove the cap and you connect it to the spacer, if it's, if you're using a spacer, then of course you put the, you tell the child to breathe out, okay, from the spacer. They breathe out first, okay, then after they breathe out, a deep breath out, then you bring the spacer to the mouth, then you press the inhaler. As you are pressing now the inhaler, they should be taking their breath in slowly. So they take their breath in slowly until it's a full breath. Then they should hold their breath. Even in asthmatic patients, it's very important that they must hold their breath. And then, of course, breathe out. If this medication that you're giving has steroids on it, if you actually read many inhalers, there are some that are combined. It's not just salbutamol, but it's salbutamol and a steroid. Then we usually also advise them to buy some mouthwash that they can actually wash in their mouth and spit out. Because if they use this with a lot of corticosteroids, inhaled corticosteroids, it would mean that they can come in with the thrush, because it also lowers the mucosal immunity. So we usually advise them to do that as well. Okay, here's another station that I know you've probably never seen before. This is a chest x-ray for a 29 weeks gestation male neonate admitted to NICU with respiratory distress. The mother is G1 para 0, presented with spontaneous preterm labor. What is the radiological finding and diagnosis? What is the perinatal intervention we can offer to the mother to prevent or reduce the severity? How do we manage this condition? What other complications are associated with this kind of neonate? I know some people in the live stream right now are probably thinking, oh no, this is a congenital heart disease. No, the heart looks like it's enlarged. No, it's not. Okay, take the history into context. This child is 29 weeks and was born and admitted to the NICU. They are in respiratory distress. Sometimes even the answer is in the history. You don't even have to look at the x-ray to tell. So already from this x-ray here, we can see that this x-ray is actually, there is a much, much more hazy appearance that you can see. So this actually looks like a typical ground glass appearance, okay, where you have this hazy appearance of the lung fields. So it's rather hazy. I'm sure I've never seen an x-ray that's as hazy as this. So most likely this child has hyaline membrane disease or respiratory distress. So they have a ground glass appearance. And they may also have some air bronchograms, which are these lines. You can see there's a dark line here. There's also another dark line here. These are like the bronchi that you can actually visualize through the consolidation. So it's a hyaline membrane disease. Thank you for pointing that out, Penlop. And what principle or what perinatal interventions can we do? We give the mother dexamethasone. Because remember, the dexamethasone is pretty much going to help with lung maturation. The second thing that we're going to be doing is magnesium sulfate. Magnesium sulfate is neuroprotective. Remember that premature children are at risk of intraventricular hemorrhage. So the magnesium sulfate is also neuroprotective. It's not just for the mother. No, because the mother had preeclampsia. The third thing is antibiotics. Okay, so cover them on antibiotics. Then how do we manage this condition? So we intubate and we connect them to a mechanical ventilator. And of course, we may administer your exogenous surfactant. Because remember, the problem in this is that surfactant hasn't been produced. Remember that surfactant is going to be produced by the type 2 pneumocytes. There are two types of pneumocytes in the lungs. You have type 1 pneumocytes, which are your squamous epithelial cells. You have type 2 pneumocytes, which are rather columnar cells, which are going to be providing or producing the surfactant. Surfactant is what reduces the work of breathing and prevents your lungs from collapsing every time you breathe out. And also when you breathe in, it makes it easier for them to expand. So the complications that may be associated with prematurity include things like your pneumothorax. It could be things like intraventricular hemorrhage, necrotizing enterocolitis, bronchopulmonary dysplasia. I wanted to spend some time on this. So if you have given this child oxygen and by day four, they're still, when you take them off oxygen, they're still desaturating, then they may have what is known as a bronchopulmonary dysplasia. So when you get an x-ray, you may see what is known as a honeycomb appearance, though I didn't put an x-ray of this. You can just simply Google honeycomb appearance on the chest x-ray. You'll be able to see what it looks like. So they may have a honeycomb appearance, and this children actually still require oxygen by 28 days of delivery, after 28 days of delivery, or even when they are 36 weeks of gestation, when they were supposed to be 36 weeks. Then you call that a zero. bronchopulmonary dysplasia. Then, of course, you may have your patent ductus atriosum and necrotizing enterocolitis, which was repeated as an answer there. Here's another station that you have never seen before. A child was born to a G3 para 2 mother at 36 weeks. Okay, 36 weeks. The child was, however, admitted to the NICU due to inability to pass meconium and having abdominal distension. An X-ray was done and is shown on the right. What is the most likely diagnosis? What is the underlying pathogenesis of this condition? How would you confirm your diagnosis? How would you manage this neonate? Okay, so this is a neonate that, number one, hasn't passed meconium. Number two, abdominal distension. And the X-ray even shows here, it's very characteristic that the gut here, the bowel here is distended. Okay, so most likely this child has Hirschsprung's disease. So they have intestinal obstruction secondary to Hirschsprung's disease. It's not necrotizing enterocolitis, Hirschsprung's disease. It's very easy to fall into the trap of thinking that it's necrotizing enterocolitis, but it will be more characteristic to have your Hirschsprung's disease in this case. So this is, of course, your congenital absence of your ganglion. Remember that if you look at the layers of the GIT, you have the mucosa, the submucosa, the internal muscular layer, the outer muscular layer, and the serosa. Now, in the mucosa, you're going to be having a plexus of neurons, which is known as your Meissner's plexus, or you can call it as a submucosal plexus if you don't want to remember very strange names. Submucosal plexus. Now, in between the inner circular muscles and the outer longitudinal muscles, that's where you have your myenteric plexus, which is also referred to as the Obex plexus. Now, remember, this plexus of nerves has sympathetic ganglion. And remember, it is the sympathetic ganglion that actually help in the contraction of the gut wall and also relaxation of the sphincter. So in the distal segment of the colon, the rectal sigmoid colon, sometimes you may have this not being present. Sometimes it may actually even affect the whole bowel, okay, the whole entire colon. And this actually leads to your bowel obstruction and your failure to pass meconium. So usually the child will come in and they're admitted having failed passing meconium. So how we confirm the diagnosis? Pretty much we want to get a rectal biopsy, and this is going to be showing the absence of the ganglion cells. Now, the management of this condition, we want to actually perform some bowel irrigation to clear the bowel and to relieve the distension. How do we do this? We get a tube, place it in the rectum, pass in normal saline, then the normal saline will come out with the bowel contents, and then that's how we help relieve the distension. But because this child also has a risk of infections, so cover them on antibiotics, give them IV fluids, and of course surgical intervention is paramount. So want to surgically resect the aganglionic bowel. So they may actually have a long-term complication of what is known as short gut syndrome, where their gut has been shortened, and sometimes you may not absorb some of the essential nutrients that are needed for this child to grow and develop. Here's another question that you have never seen before in most of your past papers. A child was born to a 39-year-old mother and admitted to living Wanawasa due to a defect depicted on the image. So how do we differentiate on X-ray from pneumatosis intestinalis? Very good question. So with pneumatosis intestinalis, there will be two borders. If you zoom in into this image here, let me just go here. If we zoom into this image, if this was pneumatosis intestinalis, the walls of the gut would have two outlines, a white line, another white line, and dark strip in between. That dark strip would be indicative of air in the bowel. That's how you're going to be distinguishing. With Hirschsprung's disease, it's just going to be abdominal distension, as seen on this picture in the child. But in pneumatosis intestinalis, you have that air in the wall. So you have that dark strip with two boundaries. So you can see here, there's just one boundary of the wall. But in pneumatosis intestinalis, you have two boundaries in the wall. So very good question. So describe what you see on the picture. What is your most likely diagnosis? What are the types of this kind of defect? Mention one feature in the mother during pregnancy. What could have been done to prevent this defect? What are the complications associated with the defect? So I know you may not have seen this in the Osce station, so it may be one of the fresh questions. So this is a child with a central midline swelling on the back, and it's consistent with an open spina bifida. So this child has probably a neurotube defect. So this is open spina bifida. So remember that there are pretty much three entities you can have. And the least severe is your spina bifida occulta, okay? The reason why it's known as occulta, it's because you can also refer to it as hidden, meaning that the defect is very small, that you don't even see it. There's no gap in the spine. There's no opening that you can see on the back. There's no sac you can see on the back. The spinal cord is okay. The nerves are okay. This one usually is only even discovered later on in childhood or later on in adulthood. The only thing that you may actually see is a patch of hair in this area. You may just see a patch of hair in this area, then you may think that this person has a spina bifida occulta. Then the other two entities are your meningocele and your myelomeningocele. Now, your meningocele, that's where you're now going to be having a sac that's protruding. It has fluid in it, and it doesn't have any spinal cord. It doesn't have any nerves trapped in it. So the spinal cord is okay. The nerves are okay. This is kind of like the intermediate. So there may be a few symptoms, but there are no neurological symptoms in this case. The most severe presentation is what is known as your myelomeningocele. Now here you have the sac that is present in the back, and you're going to be having nerves and the spinal cord present within that sac, and they're going to be damaged. So this child is going to be having some neurological symptoms. They may actually be associated hydrocephalus. They may be associated learning disability. This child may have incontinence. This child may have paralysis of the lower limbs. This child may also have loss of sensation in the lower limbs, okay? So one feature that the mother will most likely have during pregnancy is, of course, your macrocytic anemia, because they'll have a deficiency in folic acid. So you give folic acid during pregnancy to prevent this. It prevents your neurotube defects. But here's an alternate image of how they can actually ask you, or how you can come on your Osce station. So as you can see, this child here has your spina bifida. Moving on to station 14, something you're familiar with. A five-year-old presents with easy fatigability and poor growth since birth. What signs do you see? What is the most likely cause of these signs? What investigations would you order? So if you look very closely, this child's fingers, especially this thumb, is clubbed. As you can see, even this one here to a much extent. It's not so evident with these two, but this one here and this second one here. I think, let me just get back. Okay, I hope you can see my mouse. Let me just use the laser pointer. So this one here and this one here. And there's also some discoloration. There's some bluish discoloration here. So this child has finger clubbing, peripheral cyanosis. Whenever you come in and the child has... So the approach that you're going to be getting to children that come in with cardiac manifestations or congenital heart disease, most of them will come in with symptoms of failing to thrive, failing to feed, cyanosis, if it's a cyanotic heart disease. And this cyanosis is very characteristic. If the child is very young, when they feed, that's when they tend to sweat a lot. They tend to become blue. When they cry, they tend to become blue in a cyanotic congenital disease. So these are some of the things that you should keep in mind when you're approaching patients with cardiac conditions. And now, how are you going to distinguish between cyanosis that is due to cardiovascular causes versus cyanosis that is due to respiratory causes? Because remember, respiratory causes can cause cyanosis, cardiac causes can cause cyanosis. It's very simple. Give the child oxygen. If you're giving the child adequate oxygen, if they have a respiratory problem, it's going to improve. The cyanosis will improve, the saturations will improve. But if they have a heart defect, there won't be any improvement that may be there. So most likely this child has a cyanotic congenital heart disease. The investigations that you'd order, remember, anyone that comes in with cardiac problems, you want to do these three investigations: your chest x-ray, your ECG, your echo. I don't want to go into chest x-ray because there are some stations of some congenital heart diseases that I've put into this that may surprise some of you today. So you do also an echo, also a full blood count with a differential is also needed. Right, here's another station that I'm confident that you have never seen before. Some of you may have never seen this in your life. So station 15, a two-day full-term infant born with severe respiratory distress had showed the following. Describe the x-ray findings. What feature would you see on physical examination? What other investigations would you order? What is the most likely diagnosis? What complication is associated with this condition? And how would you manage? So there's a question. Why is that not congestive? Hamza, you like a lot of heart failure, huh? So heart failure here, again, would be probable, but unlikely. Remember, heart failure does cause finger clubbing. It does cause cyanosis, but it is most likely going to be associated with congenital malformations because this person has had it since birth. Okay, that's the key thing. There is no one who's born with a heart failure unless if they're born with a very, very severe congenital defect. And of course, they wouldn't survive beyond 5 years. That's why it's unlikely that this child is having heart failure. I hope that answers your question. So, station 15. So, describe the findings. What features would you see on physical examination? What other investigations would you order? What is the most likely diagnosis? What complication is associated with this condition? How would you manage? So I know this is a very, very fresh station. So let's now go through this. So something wrong here. Now, what is this here that you're seeing? What is this that you're seeing here? So this is all bowel content. Okay. This child here is what is known as a diaphragmatic hernia. Okay. So the bowel contents or the bowel is visualized in the left hemithorax, and it's even encroaching on the right lung. So it's compressing on the right lung. It's even encroaching on the heart. So the questions that we'd ask on your history to ascertain the diagnosis was this, when was the onset? Is it immediately after birth? We explore the pregnancy. What happened during pregnancy? Abnormalities on ultrasound, because you can pick this up on ultrasound. Were there any abnormalities noted on ultrasound? What was the labor history? Was it eventful? Was it uneventful? Is there any family history of congenital heart disease? Is there any family history of diaphragmatic hernias? Because remember, most of the times, if they have a diaphragmatic hernia, it may also be associated with a congenital malformation of the heart or a congenital anomaly of the heart. So our investigations that we want to order, of course, our full blood count and our differential, our arterial blood gases and ultrasound. Clinical features that you may see. This child may come in features of respiratory distress. So they may come in with features of respiratory distress. They may come in with a scaphoid abdomen, because most of the content is now in the thorax. The abdomen will become scaphoid. Then this is most likely a left-sided diaphragmatic hernia. The complications are going to be associated with this condition are going to be things like severe persistent pulmonary hypertension. And that's the major complication that you want to worry about. Now, if you make a diagnosis of this, what are you going to do on your management? Pretty much, you are going to push in an NG tube. You are going to suction the NG tube so that you can prevent dilatation of the contents in the thoracic cavity. Then after you stabilize the patient, then they have to actually go for surgery and actually they have to repair the defect, the diaphragmatic defect. Station 16, which is something you're familiar with. These are pictures of an adolescent living with HIV. Picture 1, write down your diagnosis and WHO staging. Picture 2, write down your diagnosis and WHO staging. So we'll assume that this one on the left is picture 1. This one on the right is picture 2. So what is the overall stage? So I know HIV is one of the topics that I actually haven't covered in my on my channel. So I will talk about very important things, especially for the final years. I will mention something that's very important in terms of the treatment and the drugs that we give, especially in pediatrics. So this here, as you can see, these are like flat like lesions that are there. I don't know if they look like vesicles, but they don't really look like vesicle from this picture, unless if this is not so clear, but they don't really look like vesicle. They look like rather flat lesions. So this look almost similar to verruca plana, which is a type of dermatological manifestation of HIV. So it's a verruca plana. So this is seen in the HIV, 4 stages, very important, especially for the 5th years. The first stage, they're either asymptomatic or they have the persistent generalized lymphadenopathy. Your stage 2, they have oral and cutaneous manifestations. That's what I want you to keep in mind to remember. So things like verruca plana, your pruritic papular eruptions, your seborrheic dermatitis, all those things are going to be falling under stage 2. Stage 3, they have these moderate bacteria infections. Okay, so it could moderate infections. Let me just say moderate infections. So it could be things like your oral candidiasis. Remember that oral candidiasis is stage 3. Esophageal candidiasis is stage 4. Your oral candidiasis, you may have your bacterial pneumonias. PTB is stage 3. Your pulmonary TB is your stage 3. And of course, stage 4 is if they have any cancer. If they have any opportunistic infection, automatically they go to stage 4. So stage 3, excuse me, the finger clubbing is going to be a stage 3 condition. So how the staging works is this. It's not additive, meaning you don't add them together, no. The highest clinical feature that has the highest stage, that's where the child is probably going to be. So in this case, this child is going to be at stage 3, so you put them at stage 3. So if they had just two skin manifestations, they would still be at stage 2. You wouldn't graduate them to stage 3. I hope that sheds a bit of some light on the staging. Question 17, or station 17. An 11-year-old girl, HIV positive pre-heart, for 2 years presents with epistaxis, hematuria, and palpitations for 3 days. On examination, she has generalized lymphadenopathy and a generalized hyperpigmented itchy rash. Hemogram, WBC was 0.4, that's very low. HB was 6, that is low. Platelets was 48. What is her WHO staging? Mention 6 further tests you would do. Which first line regimen would you initiate and what other treatment would you give? Mention 2 complications of these drugs. Okay? Now, it's very easy here to now jump the gun. You forget everything and say, okay, this child has generalized lymphadenopathy, which is at stage 1. The rash, which is at stage 2. And you would say, okay, this person is at stage 2. You'd get it wrong. Severely wrong. Why? This child also has severe, they have pancytopenia. They have thrombocytopenia, neutropenia, and they also have a decreased HB. So most likely this person is at stage 3. You see these things at stage 3. So the other test that you would actually order, a CD4 count or a viral load, for obvious reasons. Blood cultures. Okay. You can also do a peripheral smear because you want to find out what is going on. It could be that this child has a malignancy. Number 3, urine or stool microscopy culture and sensitivity. Get a chest x-ray, get an ECG, get an echo. Remember that anemia can tip someone into heart failure. And also there are also other sepsis can also have some manifestations in the cardiovascular system. Get an echo as well. But that wouldn't be usually the first things that you do. ECG and echo maybe shouldn't be top of the list. Maybe the last things when you run out of things to say in your exam. A clotting profile is very important. This person has a platelet count of 48. They come in with hematuria. They come in with epistaxis, which is nose bleeding. They are bleeding from every orifice. So pretty much you also want to do a clotting profile. Your liver function tests to check, because before you start them on treatment, you have to ensure that their liver is intact. Your renal function test, that's your urea, electrolytes, creatinine. You want to make sure that the creatinine clearance, this is very important. This is what I wanted to talk to you about, especially the final year students. Creatinine clearance is very important. If the person has, if this person had TB, and we now come to the treatment, whenever you have TB and HIV, we generally keep in mind that I want you to avoid tenofovir. Okay, TB treatment. HIV, avoid tenofovir, replace it with abacavir. Okay, so it means that if you were to start this child, you start them on abacavir. Okay, then how are you going to combine these drugs? Remember, we combined 2 nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors plus 1 integrase inhibitors because this child is 11 years old. Okay, so you can either use tenofovir or lamivudine or emtricitabine plus dolutegravir. Those are the 3 drugs that you would initiate treatment on. Oh, abacavir, our alternative regimen is abacavir, your lamivudine, and dolutegravir. Alternatively, we can also use tenofovir, lamivudine, and efavirenz, but this one is not really a common regimen that we actually use, but it's also as an alternative regimen. The other thing that you want to do for this child is transfuse them. They have an HB of 6. Transfuse them, not only with packed cells, but with platelets and also FFP, because this child is bleeding. Give them vitamin K as well. Cover them on antibiotics. These are just some of the things that I do not necessarily add to the marking key, but I do think of them on the spot. So do that for the management of this child. So complications of these drugs, especially with the nucleoside reverse transcriptase inhibitors, they're very notorious to cause bone marrow suppression. They're also very notorious to cause renal failure, especially with tenofovir, like I told you. You should be able to know all the side effects of the HIV drugs. You should be able to know the groups, the names, and the side effects. Okay, so I just wanted us to go through this, especially with the final years. I just wanted us to go through this. Now, this is specifically for pediatrics. So I just look at the ones that are in yellow. These ones in yellow. So if the child is less than 2 weeks, we usually cover them on AZT, 3TC, and nevirapine, because I know that's what most of you were shouting for in the previous question. Why aren't we starting this child on AZT, 3TC, and nevirapine? It's because this is now only reserved for children that are 0 to 2 weeks and those that are nevirapine naive, that those that have never been on nevirapine prophylaxis before. Alternative regimen is we can give AZT, 3TC, and Rautegravir, which is also another integrase inhibitor. Now, if it's a child between 2 weeks and less than 5 years, now it depends on their weight. Okay? Depends on their weight. If they're less than 20 kg, will you give your ABC, yes, your Bacava, your Lamivudine, and your boosted Lopinavir? So Lopinavir with like a small R here is known as boosted Lopinavir. It's Lopinavir plus Ritonavir. That's our preferred regimen. These are current guidelines, okay? Preferred regimen. If they're between 20 to 24.9 kilograms, Abacavir, Lamivudine, and Dolutegravir. If they are greater than 25 kg or greater than 30 kg, that's your Tenofovir, Lamivudine, and Dolutegravir. So pretty much these ones above 20 kg, the regimens are pretty much the same. The only difference is substituting ABC for Tenofovir. Then if it's a child co-infected with TB, we want to avoid the Tenofovir. Okay, we can only give tenofovir. There are two preparations of tenofovir. There's tenofovir allopurinol and there's tenofovir TDF. Okay, there's TAF, TAF, and there's TDF. For those that are with TB, we can give TDF depending on the creatinine clearance of the individual. It's a very good read. If you look into the guidelines, you'd read up on the details of this. Then for those that are less than 20 kg with TB, you give the ABC regimen. So a Bacava regimen. I hope this makes sense on the treatment. So you can either give Lamivudine or you can give Emtricitabine. So when you see XTC somewhere in some place, like for example here where it says XTC, XTC here, or XTC here in adults and adolescents, XTC just means you can either give Emtricitabine, which is FTC, or Lamivudine, which is 3TC. I hope this makes a whole lot more sense now. Moving on to station 19. Provided is a hemogram of a 7-year-old boy. Describe salient features you see. What additional investigations would you request? What is your impression? Mention any two possible causes of this picture. So as we can see here, WBC is 0.6, just like the friend earlier on. It's very low. RBC is 1.88, also very low. Hemoglobin 6.8, also very low. Hematocrit 18%, also very low. MCV 99.4, which is normal. Your MCHC 36, it's high. Your MCHC is high. Your RDW is low. I mean, your RDW is high, not low. It's high. Then your platelet count is low. So those are the abnormalities that we see here. So this child has a low WBC count, a low red blood cell count, a low platelet, and a low hematocrit. Okay, so there's a question. HIV co-infection, you avoid TAF, then double the frequency of DTG to twice a day. Yes, exactly. Exactly that. That's what you do. So thanks, Harrison, for that contribution. Then, so your low white blood cell and your RBC, your platelet and your hematocrit are also low, and then also high MCV and MCHC. Then, of course, the RDW is also increased. So when you see such a similar picture, this child here has some bone marrow failure. So there are different causes of bone marrow failure. But take note that this child is 7 years old. You don't want to jump the gun, but most likely this child has an aplastic type of anemia. Okay, they have aplastic anemia, which is usually attributed to either a genetic disorder that's known as a Fanconi anemia, but sometimes can be due to myelofibrosis. It can sometimes be due to... Now, how are you going to investigate this child? Peripheral smear to see what is going on. What is the morphology of these cells? A bone marrow aspirate to see what's going on in the bone marrow. Maybe this child is suppressing the bone marrow. And then, of course, the reticulocyte count. You may also do a corrected reticulocyte count in this child to see if the bone marrow is indeed responding like it's supposed to. Question 20. This one is every student's favorite station, if I'm not mistaken. This is the chest x-ray of a two-year-old with cyanosis. Describe the salient features. What is the possible diagnosis? List any four differential diagnoses for the cyanosis. Mention any two other signs the patient may present with. So this is very, very characteristic. So this one has a boot-shaped heart. Okay, it's shaped like a boot here. As you can see, it's like a boot, a baby boot. Okay. So a boot-shaped heart. I don't know. It's supposed to be cardiac. I think this was cut off. Cardiac silhouette. It just means as a heart shadow. They also have very pale lung fields. The lung fields here are oligemic. So very pale lung fields. Excuse me. Then this is very consistent with tetralogy of Fallot. Remember in tetralogy of Fallot, it's a congenital, a cyanotic congenital by four things. It's characterized by one, you have a pulmonary subpulmonic stenosis. So this is causing right ventricular outflow obstruction. Number two, you have right ventricular hypertrophy. Because remember that the output is blocked. So you have to generate a greater pressure. The right ventricle will actually enlarge. That's what is responsible for giving you this boot-shaped heart. That's the second thing. The third thing is that there is an associated ventricular septal defect. And the third thing is you have overriding of the aorta, where part of the aorta is also receiving inputs from both the right and the left ventricle. So the other cyanotic congenital heart diseases that are there, of course, they begin with T's. Your tricuspid atresias, your transposition of the great vessels, your truncus atriosum, your total anomalous venous, pulmonary venous drainage. Then, of course, two signs that you may elicit, you may get a loud harsh systolic ejection murmur. And you may also get finger clubbing. Okay, in this children, they tend to present with what is known as tet spells. So as they grow much older, they tend to actually realize how to get out of a tet spell. So the characteristic history that you'll get is this child is playing, all of a sudden they go into a cyanotic spell, they'll squat. When they squat, it means that this is increasing your systemic vascular resistance such that you can reverse the shunt that you are having there. Because remember that the defect here in children that have congenital heart defects is that there's a shunt of blood where oxygenated blood is going to mix, or deoxygenated blood will mix with oxygenated blood. Here's an alternate question that you can be asked on your exam. So the same question, different x-ray, but different questions. You have described features, the exact same features in this case. You also have horizontalization of the ribs. They look rather horizontal, but this is not really surprising as much in a child. Then, because they tend to be much more horizontal than in adults. Then the two signs, I've already mentioned the two signs. The symptoms could be that this child could have a poor feeding. They could have failure to thrive. They may even have prolonged crying. Now, the two tests that you're going to order, an ECG, is going to show you features of right ventricular hypertrophy. So it's going to be showing, you may see your right axis deviation on your ECG. An echo is very important because you see the defects, you see the VSD, you're able to measure the thickness of the right ventricle, you'll be able to see the pulmonic or subpulmonic stenosis on the echo. So ECG and echo are very, very important. Now the drugs that we give, number one, we can give morphine. How is morphine going to be working? Remember, morphine is pretty much going to be suppressing the respiratory centers. It's going to be having a sedative effect. So remember, as the respiratory centers are depressed, it means that even the child is much more sedated. The tachypnea or the anxiety that is there is also abolished, because this is also making the tet spell worse. The other thing that you can do is increase the systemic vascular resistance. Or we can reduce the spasms of the infundibulum. This is pretty much, in essence, in English, this is just to relieve the ventricular obstruction. So we can use drugs like propranolol, which is a beta blocker, phenylephrine, which is an alpha agonist, or we can even use ketamine, which has both a sedative effect and also increases the vascular resistance. Now, because this person is tachypneic and they're losing a lot of carbon dioxide, remember carbon dioxide in the blood is what is responsible for the production of the bicarbonate, which eventually dissociates to hydrogen ions plus bicarbonate ions. And then, of course, the hydrogen ions are the ones that make the blood acidic. So this person here is going to be in acidosis. So we can give them sodium bicarbonate. But of course, this should be given because it has a risk of the child actually developing our cerebral edema. So we generally want to avoid sodium bicarbonate, especially in children. So four possible complications, including things like thromboembolism, thrombi, bacterial endocarditis, arrhythmias, heart failure. Okay, station 21. This is a hemogram of a 10-year-old boy who presented with a 2-month history of fever, loss of appetite, generalized body weakness, and abdominal fullness. WBC was 165. MCV was 86. MCH was 30.6. Our MCHC was 36.3. HP was 7.9. Platelets was 167. And our reticulocyte count was 9.57%. List down the abnormalities in the hemogram. Give 2 differential diagnoses. List down 2 preliminary investigations that would help you confirm the diagnosis. After confirming your diagnosis, list 3 therapeutic measures you would take to prepare your patient for definitive treatment. So we can already agree that the white blood cell count is very high. 165, that's quite high. Okay. The platelet count is low, or rather, it's slightly within the normal range. The HB is low. The reticulocyte count is high. So this person has a very high WBC, a low HB, and a very high reticulocyte count. Most likely, this person can either have acute or rather chronic leukemias. It's much more likely that this child has an acute leukemia. Okay, but remember that we may not rule out chronic leukemias because they do sometimes even show up in children. Very rare, but they do sometimes show up in children. How would you distinguish? Pretty much there are different markers that you can use to distinguish the different types of the leukemias. The cluster of differentiation proteins is a compound that's known as TDT. So you can check for TDT, you can check for the cluster of differentiation proteins to be able to distinguish between these. These are molecular techniques. But generally, your starting point will be your peripheral smear, your bone marrow aspirate. Now, if you're treating any, this is a very important point. If you're treating any patient with a cancer, a tumor, especially tumors that are rapidly dividing, remember that the drugs that you're going to be giving, especially if they are cytotoxic drugs, they are going to decrease the cellular turnover. So it means that there's going to be, increase the cellular death. So it means that there's going to be a lot of cells that are killed. So it means that there's going to be a lot of release of uric acid. There's a lot of release of potassium. So there's a high risk of this child actually going into a complication that is known as tumor lysis syndrome. So we want to hydrate the child. We may actually use plasmapheresis to filter out their blood, a blood transfusion. You may also give them allopurinol before the treatment. Session 22. Another thing that never misses from your exams. A child presents to the hospital as shown in the image. Describe the findings, classify the causes, and give 1 pathology in each. What other clinical features would you look for? Why are the child's eyes in this position? Mention any 2 long-term complications. So if you have never seen this condition before, then I don't know. So this child has a prominent forehead, an abnormal contour of the head. Okay, they have dilated scalp vessels. As you can see here, the scalp vessels are rather dilated. And this here, it's like as if the sun is setting. So you call these as a sunset eyes. These are features that are very consistent with hydrocephalus or hydrocephaly, or however you want to pronounce it. So it may be classified in 2 ways. There's 1 classification which classifies it as obstructive versus non-obstructive. If you want to classify it that way, you can go ahead and classify it that way. There's another classification that classifies it as congenital versus acquired, which is what I've used here. So the congenital are things like a stenosis of the equiduct of Sylvius or the cerebral equiduct. If that is blocked, congenitally, if a child is born with that is blocked. The second is what's known as a Dandy Walker malformation. So here you have the vermis of the cerebellum. Because if you look at the way CSF flows from the fourth ventricle, or the lateral ventricles to the fourth ventricle, or rather third ventricle, from the third ventricle to the fourth ventricle. Okay, so now the fourth ventricle actually happens to be passing through, or these ventricles happen to be passing through the cerebellum. There's a part that passes through the cerebellum. So if you have absence of the vermis, you may sometimes have a posterior wall cyst in the fourth ventricle that can be blocking the flow of CSF. And of course, sometimes you may have an Arnold Chiari malformation where you have herniation of the cerebellum and the magnum, the cerebellum and the medulla through the foramen magnum. Then these are congenital causes. Then acquired, you can have infectious things like TB meningitis, chronic or pyogenic meningitis. even non-infectious causes. It could be tumors in the posterior fossa of the cranium, like medulloblastomas, astrocytomas, ependymomas. Remember that the bulk majority of the tumors that we get in children are gliomas, because the nerves do not divide. What are dividing are the glial cells, the astrocytes, the ependymal cells. Then you may also sometimes have intracranial hemorrhage that's causing hydrocephaly. You may have a ruptured aneurysm. Now, what are the clinical features would you look for? Number one, this child will have an increasing head circumference. Number two, the sutures will be split apart. Okay. Number three, that's if the child hasn't yet reached the part where now the fontanelles and all those things have sealed up. If it's in a much older child, they'll come to you with features of increased intracranial pressure. So the vomiting, the decrease in levels of consciousness, and the severe headache. Then they may also have a crackpot sound on percussion. So as you percuss this, it sounds like a crackpot. Then why this here, the eyes are in this position? It's because of the increase in intracranial pressure. So there is compression of the midbrain, and there's a compression of the centers in the midbrain that are responsible for upward gazing. So for you to be able to move your eyes upwards, up and down, like I'm moving my eyes right now. So once you compress this area or pressure to this area in the midbrain, then the eyes will be in that position. Two long-term complications, learning disabilities, we don't want to call it mental retardation, epilepsy, as well as cerebral palsy. Here are alternate images that they can bring you. Here's one image that is on a CT scan. This dark thing here is a ventricle. It's a huge, it's very dilated. It's a ventricle. This is a ventricle here. These are ventricles. Here's one. The head is quite huge and quite shiny, frankly. Then here's another one who appears much more sick. This child appears much happier than the other children. And then this one here just looks shocked. Okay, so all this is alternate images that they can bring you on hydrocephalus. Here's other ultimate images that I want you to keep in mind. Because remember that how we treat this in children, we can give medical treatment where we treat the underlying cause, or we can give them a drug that's known as acetazolamide. Now, acetazolamide is a carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. So it inhibits the enzyme carbonic anhydrase. Now, carbonic anhydrase is an enzyme that is very essential in the synthesis of cerebrospinal fluid. Now, once we inhibit this enzyme, we reduce the production of cerebrospinal fluid. The other end of the spectrum, we can manage these children surgically. So we pretty much want to give a shunt. So there are different types of shunts that you can make. Here you have a child that has a subcutaneous shunt. Here the shunt has even been, it can be a ventricular osseous shunt, where it's from the ventricle to the bones. It could be a ventricular peritoneal, it could be a ventricular atrial, ventricular pleural, whatever shunt is there. Now, there are some complications that sometimes they may ask you about the shunts. So the shunts can be blocked, they can be dislodged. Someone can develop what is known as a shunt nephritis. Sometimes they may even have a slit ventricular syndrome, where they form these tumor pockets or these slits within the shunts. These are some of the complications. And of course, the child may outgrow the shunt. Station 23. A 9-year-old patient is brought to Living Manawasa University Teaching Hospital with a history of vomiting, weight loss, and passing a lot of urine for 2 weeks. On examination, he is lethargic with dry mucous membranes. RBS is 28 millimoles. Weight is 20 kg. What other questions would you like to ask the mother? What is the possible diagnosis? What investigations will you do? What are the possible complications of your diagnosis? Now, whenever you get a question where they ask you about your history, I want you now to train your mind in this manner. This is how I want you to think about it. Imagine you're this person that is in this scenario that is supposed to be taking the history of this child. How are you going to be taking the history to reach a diagnosis? So the first thing that should come to your mind is, what are they trying to lead me towards? Here, the child has vomiting, weight loss, passing a lot of urine, and a very high blood glucose. So this child could have diabetes. This child could be in DKA. Okay? So now your question should be tailored into that manner. If you do this, it makes it very easy for you to think of the questions that you're going to be asking on your history. So what are we going to ask? Number one, history of diabetes in this child. Number two, history of diabetes in the family. Number three, if they have any history of a fever, upper respiratory symptoms. Why am I asking this? It's because infections tend to trigger DKA. Because remember, you're keeping in mind this child has DKA. So infections can trigger this. when was their last meal? Because again, also high, if they're not eating, or if they're even on any medication, especially if they're on insulin and they're not complying to the insulin, then that could be a cause of them coming in DKA. What's their HIV status like? And is there any history of similar illness before? So this is most likely a type 1 diabetes mellitus. They probably are in DKA. So you're going to be managing this with your full blood count, with your differential, your urinalysis, your urea and electrolytes, your creatinine, and you can perform an oral glucose tolerance test. But in this case, in retrospect, I think cancel out the oral glucose tolerance test. We can just remove that completely because this child already, maybe if there's no diagnosis of diabetes that is done, maybe, but they're coming in with DKA. So just cancel out the oral glucose tolerance test. And what possible complications of your diagnosis? So diabetic retinopathy, your macro and micro angiopathy. So pretty much your diabetic retinopathy, your diabetic nephropathy, and your neuropathy. You can ignore the DKA also here at the last slot. Okay, this is the one that I promised to shock you guys with. I know most of you will be saying, haven't we already done this question? Okay, let's read the question. This is the chest x-ray of a three-year-old toddler. Okay, so there's a question here from Martha. Why not add dehydration in the diagnosis? Very great. Okay, yes, we can add dehydration. But then again, if you think about it, dehydration is an entity in DKA. So if you say DKA, the dehydration is a feature of DKA. So you can weigh, but I always say this. It's better you have more to your answer than less. If examiner is marking two different papers and someone writes DKA with dehydration versus someone writing just DKA, obviously the person with DKA or dehydration, maybe the examiner will give them more marks as opposed to this one who has just written DKA. So we can add that. So more is always better than less. Thank you for that contribution. So coming to this, what about HHS? Oh, someone asked a question about HHS. So now remember that HHS is not really a complication of type 1 diabetes. We mostly see it in pretty much type 2. But now we have seen that this is spectrum. The reason why we're not really committing to HHS is because they haven't really told us about the findings on the urine. If there were no ketones in the urine or no ketones in the blood, then it would be hyperglycemic hypoosmolar state. So keep that in mind. I'm not totally ruling it out, but it's unlikely. In children, it's more likely that they will present to you in DKA. Thanks for that contribution, Saint. What a name. So, station 24. This is a chest x-ray of a toddler, 3 years old. And write down the most striking feature. Name three pathophysiological entities that may explain your findings in question one. List down three clinical findings that may be consistent with the radiological picture. Write down one further investigation that would help you differentiate the three pathological entities. So I want you to think about this question very, very well and look at the x-ray very well and tell me what you think the answer may be. So I'll just keep quiet for 10 seconds. Or rather, is 10 seconds enough? So 30 seconds. I'll keep quiet for 30 seconds. I want you to tell me. I'll be having a look at the chat and see what you think the answer is. So what do you think the answer is in this case? Don't be afraid to get it wrong. It's better to get it wrong here than in the exam. Okay, so tell me, what do you think? I'm waiting. No pressure, by the way. So no one wants to attempt. I'm waiting for some answers in the chat. I know most of you, I think I may have put off all of you when I say that some of you say we've already done this station before. I take back that statement. You can answer now. Okay, so someone has said tetralogy of Fallot with pulmonary edema. Okay. What are they saying? Boot-shaped heart. Okay, interesting. What are they saying? Someone is saying pneumonia. Okay. Anything else? Anything else? So we have tetralogy of Fallot with pulmonary edema, boot-shaped heart. Someone has pneumonia. Someone has also said boot-shaped heart with tetralogy of Fallot. Okay, so it's very easy to fall into the trap of actually saying tetralogy of Fallot and saying boot-shaped heart. Very, very easy to fall into this trap. Okay, so this isn't really a boot-shaped heart. If you follow the outline of this heart here, just so now I just want you to follow my cursor. Someone has said egg on a string. Very good. Zewelanji, Aline, Temwanji. Very good. This looks like an egg on a string. So this here, see this? It looks like an egg. It's in the shape of an egg. I don't know who comes up with these signs or who makes up these signs. Then this here looks like an egg on a string. So this is very characteristic of transposition of the great vessels. So this child here has transposition of the great arteries. Okay, remember in transposition of the great vessels is actually one of the most common congenital heart diseases. It's not even tetralogy of Fallot. In adults, those that reach adulthood, maybe tetralogy of Fallot. But in newborn babies, this is actually far much more common, where you have now switching of the aorta with the pulmonary trunk. So the pulmonary trunk will be arising from the left atrium. The aorta will be arising from the right ventricle. Okay, so this is an egg-shaped heart. So it's an egg on a string sign. Okay, please keep this in mind. Don't just have that knee-jerk response of saying this looks like a boot shape. Keep it in mind. Very important. So the entities, there are about four common entities that can be seen. Firstly, you may have transposition of the great arteries with an intact ventricular septum. So the ventricular septum is intact. Remember that this is a condition that is dependent on a shunt. So this person must either have an ASD, a VSD, or a PDA for them to survive. Because this, if you now separate these two circulations, it makes it almost impossible for the child to survive. So the first entity, they may have a transposition of the great arteries with an intact ventricular septum. Okay. And remember, why does this happen? It's because of the development. If you look at the embryology of how the heart actually develops, you know that the aorta in the pulmonary trunk actually developed from one structure, which is known as the aortico-pulmonary trunk. Then eventually, at some point, they're supposed to divide and the heart is supposed to rotate at some point. So the first entity is you could have transposition of the great arteries with an intact ventricular septum. The second is you could have transposition of the great arteries with a ventricular septal defect. The third is that you may have transposition of the great arteries with a ventricular septal defect and a left ventricular outflow obstruction. And of course, the fourth is you could have a transposition of the great vessels with a ventricular septal defect and a pulmonary vascular obstructive disease. Okay, now what are the clinical features that are going to be consistent with this type of presentation? Okay, how do you differentiate this from a boot-shaped heart? A boot-shaped heart will be much lower. This aspect here will be much lower. I'll show you the next slide, which is much more characteristic. This one here may confuse you a bit, but I'll show you the next slide. Just hang in there. So the clinical presentation, the first entity where you have an intact ventricular septal defect, you may just have prominent and progressive cyanosis in this child, and it will present very early, within the first 24 hours. Within the first 24 hours, they present you with your cyanosis. That's usually a very significant thing in this type of entity. The second entity where you have the transposition of the great vessels with your large ventricular septal defect. So initially, they may not actually present with any manifestations. So initially, the infants may not present with any heart disease, but there may be some mild cyanosis that may be there, especially when they are crying. So there may be cyanosis when they are crying. There may be some signs of congestive heart failure. Okay, so there may be things like tachypnea, there may be things like tachycardia, there may be things like diaphoresis, there may be things like failure to gain weight. Okay, these are going to be becoming very apparent roughly at around 3 to 6 weeks because the pulmonary blood flow increases. Now, why you're saying that, I love how someone said pneumonia. Okay, I love how someone said pneumonia. There was even someone who said in the chat box, if I'm not mistaken, let me just quickly check. Someone had said pulmonary edema. Okay, very good. Why? It's because of the increase in vascularity on this x-ray. That's how it looks like, as if there's a lot going on in the lungs. Then you may sometimes have your transposition of your great vessels with your ventricular septal defect and also with your left ventricular outflow obstruction. Now, initially, these patients are going to be presenting with extreme cyanosis at birth. And usually the proportion of this of the ventricular defect, or rather, it's going to be proportional. The cyanosis will be proportional to the ventricular defect or the ventricular obstruction that you have, the outflow obstruction that you're going to be having. So it's very similar to tetralogy of Fallot, very, very similar. Then, of course, if they have transposition of the great vessels with a ventricular septal defect and pulmonary vascular obstruction, then, of course, they may have this progressive pulmonary vascular obstructive disease. And then, of course, a rare subgroup of these patients may actually develop symptoms of heart failure. Okay, now what is going to be able to distinguish between these entities is pretty much your echocardiograph. You'll be able to see these defects on your echo. So echo is the one thing that you would want to do. Okay, here's one, an alternate image. Here's one here that looks a bit more characteristic of a neck shape. So here's an image that looks rather like a neck shape. So keep it in mind. This is very different. If I brought this image, I knew that most of you would have said something else as a side to tetralogy of Fallot. So I hope you are able to see that this one here doesn't look like a boot. Okay? Because in this case, these right ventricular hypertrophy is not really seen. Okay? Station 25. So I hope that answers your question on how you differentiate it from a boot shaped. That picture is much more distinctive. So it's more shaped like an egg or ovoid or globular rather than your boot shape. Then station 25, this is a six-year-old who presented with fever, and these are the skin lesions the following day, and the fingers appeared gangrenous, and he lapses into shock. How do you call these skin lesions? What is your diagnosis? What is the most likely causative organism? Give three essential investigations towards the diagnosis. So you can see someone here has fever. They are six, they present with these skin lesions, and they go into shock. There's only one thing that can explain all these things. You should think in this way. It could be that there's a gram-negative infection. Most likely, the most common gram-negative infection that presents you with this is Neisseria meningitidis. So this child has a meningococcemia. Possibly a Waterhouse-Fredrickson syndrome because of the shock that is there, and they are gangrenous. The fingers are gangrenous, so there's a cardiovascular collapse. So these are known as erythematous maculopapular rash, or you can call them as petechiae. But I just want you to refer to it as erythematous maculopapular rash. It makes you sound more technical, and you get better marks. And of course, the essential things that you want to do, your full blood count, your coagulation profile, your blood cultures. Here's another video, okay? But if we say trunkocerciosis caused the knob, there's a question, caused the aortic knob and the pulmonary trunk looked kind of fused. Or let's go back to the question, the aortic knob and the pulmonary trunk. Well, not characteristically. Yeah, I get what you're saying, and it would be similar to trunkocerciosum, but the in trunkocerciosum, you wouldn't get this characteristic egg-shaped appearance of the heart. Okay, but I do get that. That's a very, very valid point that you have raised up with your trunkocerciosum, where you have both the right ventricle and the left ventricle joined or draining into the aorta. I do get your point, but it's most likely at transposition of the great vessels. Thanks for that contribution. Then here's a video that I am pretty sure you have never seen before. Some of you may have, but who knows? Let's give it a try. So you can be commenting in the chat box about what you think this is. So watch the video and answer the following questions. What sign? I want you to list the sign in from this video. So I'm going to play the video now. So I want you to watch the video closely. So what do you think that is? I'll play the video once more. All right, Lwendo, very great. So this is what is known as a Goa sign, okay? It's known as a Goa sign. So it's a Goa's maneuver. So patients that have muscle weakness, when they're getting up from a supine position or from seated, they get up in this characteristic manner. It's referred to as a Goa sign, okay? So the two conditions that we see with Goa sign, keep in mind, is Duchenne's muscular dystrophy as well as a Becker's muscular dystrophy. They are muscle problems, muscle dystrophies. You can read up on them. Conditions are not so common, but on Osce stations, you may sometimes get a video like this on an Osce station. So just be vigilant out for that. Okay? Goa sign. I'll play it one more time so that you can commit it to memory and remember it's a Goa sign. All right, great. We move. This is a 2-year-old neonate born by spontaneous vaginal delivery. List down two potential problems you would examine this neonate for as a result of this mode of delivery. Name three complications related to this neonate. What would you want to know about the mother to help with the diagnosis? This is one way in which they can bring you this question. An alternate way in which they can bring you this question is that they may characteristically just bring you a similar picture or even sometimes a video where now they'll give you a history that this mother now gave birth via C-section. And this is what is shown in. So if you were to look at this picture, what's one striking feature would you actually note from this picture? This infant looks rather large. I've seen babies, a lot of babies, and babies aren't really this large. This infant looks rather large. So this is a fetal macrosomia, okay? So there could have been a history of an obstetric brachial plexus injury. There could have been a history of a birth fracture. It could be fractured humerus, a fractured clavicle, even hip subluxation, which is a hip dislocation, a partial hip dislocation. These are some of the risks that come with delivering a big baby or macrosomic baby. So the important things that you want to look out for, you want to do an RBS on this child because they have a risk of hypoglycemia. Most of the cases of the babies that come in with fetal macrosomia, you'll find out that it's in the background of the mother actually having had diabetes mellitus. Now remember that when a mother has diabetes, there is a very nice enzyme that is, a nice hormone rather, that is produced by the placenta, which is known as human placental lactogen. Now what human placenta, please work, please work. Can you guys hear me now? Hope you can, because I've been really trying to fix this. Are we back on now? Please, please confirm if you can hear me. We can, okay, fine, great. So this was the last question that we left on. Please tell everyone else that the stream is now back on, and sorry to all those that have been trying to reach me out, and anyone who's been trying to reach me out, please tell them. We'll give them a few minutes to rejoin the stream. I had a glitch in my network. I don't know what went wrong. Why is my network glitching again? Okay. It's audible? It's still audible? Okay, can you guys hear me? Okay, so what was did you guys get the answer for station 26? Did I finish answering the station 26? Okay, I'm seeing a lot of yeses. Sorry. Station 31, I didn't realize that my stream had cut. So it stopped halfway at station 26. Okay, let me just redo the entire station. Okay. So this is a 2-hour-old neonate that's born with spontaneous vaginal delivery. And list down two potential problems you would see. So like I said, the striking feature that you would see in this child is that this child is macrosomic. So you're going to be looking out for injuries, obstetric brachial plexus injuries as associated, especially if this child is giving birth via spontaneous vaginal delivery. Birth fractures, so things like fracture of the humerus, fracture of the clavicle, even hip subluxation, which is your dislocation. And then I said another alternative way in which they can ask you this question is that sometimes they can ask you based on whether this child was delivered via C-section and then admitted to the NICU, then this child is appearing macrosomic. Now remember that in pregnancy, there is a hormone that's known as human placental lactogen. Now what human placental lactogen does is that it takes the glucose from the mother and channels it to the child. So the high blood glucose in the mother will also be indicative of a high blood glucose within the child. So this child will have hyperglycemia and this will trigger a lot of insulin release in the child. So the insulin, remember that insulin is an anabolic hormone. And this insulin that happens to be an anabolic hormone is pretty much going to cause this child to gain weight. Now, when they are born, they still have these high levels of insulin in their blood, and this can actually tip them into hypoglycemia. They may actually have metabolic syndromes. They may have hypertension. They may have hypoglycemia. They may have increased cholesterol. They may even have talipes calcanovirus, which is pretty much the clubbed foot, or your metatarsus adductus. Now, the things that you are actually supposed to look out for in this child is that there may be a history of diabetes in the mother. There may be a history of macrosomia in the family. There may be even a history of macrosomia in the previous pregnancies of the mother. Those are the things that you should look out for when you get a macrosomic baby. So it means you should check out the RBS of this child, monitor the electrolytes of this child, and all children that are macrosomic are supposed to be admitted to the NICU. Now here's another station 27. So station 27 shows an instrument that I'm sure you may have seen somewhere. So what is this equipment called? What are the indications? What are the sites where you do the procedure from? So the equipment is, of course, this is a bone marrow biopsy needle, and it's diagnostic because it's used to collect samples for bone marrow examination. It's especially in cases of leukemia, in cases of bone marrow failure. The two sites where we actually collect these samples is from the sternum as well as the iliac crest. So we get it from the sternum, we also get it from the iliac crest. Keep that in mind. Now, station 28, it's never a malaria station, or an Osce station if you don't have malaria in it. So a 10-year-old child presents to the hospital with generalized body swelling, anasaka, and an elevated temperature of 38 degrees Celsius. Preliminary investigations are done. A full blood count taken shows hemoglobin 8 grams per deciliter, white blood cells of 8, your neutrophils of 30%, your lymphocytes of 20%, and your platelets of 33%. A red blood cell distribution width is 26%. So a blood slide is collected and the results are shown in the image. So what abnormalities are present from the full blood count? What does the blood slide show? What is the full diagnosis? What other investigations would you undertake? So this here, this child here has a low HB. They have a low platelet count. They have an increase in the red cell distribution width. And they, of course, have neutropenia. 30% is quite low. Now, these are ringforms. These are ringforms that are seen here. Now, what I was saying as I was talking to myself incidentally, because I had continued and I didn't know that the stream had cut until I looked at the chat and people were saying that the stream had cut. So as I was talking to myself, what I said was that when you're saying investigations, there's no reason, there's no point why you should say that we're going to get an RDT for malaria. That doesn't make sense. Why doesn't it make sense? They've already done a peripheral smear for you. Why then do you want to do an RDT? For what? For who? How? Okay, so RDT, you wouldn't want to go and mention that in the investigations and expect to get marks. No. Even if I was marking your paper, I'd give you a zero. Okay? Full blood count has already been given you and you want to throw it back to the examiner, full blood count again in the exam, you would still get a zero. So the other investigations that you would order, of course, your LFTs, your coagulation panel, because this person has a platelet count of 33, your serum glucose, severe malaria has a risk of them having hypoglycemia, and your urea, electrolytes, and creatinine. Now, this is, of course, why am I saying this is severe malaria? They have the swelling, generalized body swelling, which could signify that they may have an acute kidney injury. So this would be the reason why they're coming in swelling. They also have a high temperature. They have a very low platelets. So they may even have a disseminated intravascular coagulation. Now moving on to station 29. Shown is a picture of a child that presented to the emergency department with respiratory distress and stridor. Describe the abnormalities shown in the picture. What is the diagnosis? What is the causative organism? What is the type of inflammation caused by the organism? List three complications. So if we look at the back of this mouth of this child has this membranous-like structures. Sometimes it looks like pus, but sometimes they're rather characteristically white. And this child has this swelling of the neck, which is similar to what we see in Ludwig's angina. So most likely, this child has a condition that's known as diphtheria. So this child has a bone neck here. They have a pseudomembranes in the posterior oropharynx. And of course, the causative organism is your Corynebacterium diphtheriae. The type of inflammation that's associated with diphtheria is what is referred to as your acute pseudomembranous inflammation. And three complications are going to be things like cranial nerve palsies. There could be respiratory failure. There could be myocarditis. There could be renal tubular necrosis because of the toxins that are pretty much produced by these things. Then moving on to station 30, a patient presents with a history of fever, headache, and neck pain. Keep in mind, fever, headache, neck pain. So fever, headache, leukorigidity, which is usually associated with neck pain. That should tell you something. So what is your diagnosis? What is the causative organism? How would you treat? So most likely, this person here has a meningitis, okay? And a bacterial meningitis. To be specific, Neisseria meningitis. This is how it looks like when you stain it. If you actually zoom in much closer, they'll actually have a rather a coffee bean type of appearance. Now, how would you manage these children? You pretty much want to admit them. You want to treat any hypoglycemia. Remember, we avoid 50% dextrose in children, so you are safer off giving lower concentrations like your 10% in children. And we want to give them intravenous broad-spectrum antibiotics. So things like cephalosporins, cefotaxime if they're neonates, ceftriaxone if they're older than the neonates. Then crystalline penicillins can be used as an alternative. Actually, Neisseria meningitis actually responds much better to penicillins. And of course, we want to monitor their vitals, give them antipyretics to prevent or to bring down the fevers. Intravenous fluids, so you can give them 2/3 of their fluid requirements. Why? Because there's a risk of syndrome of inappropriate ADH secretion. Then, of course, we want to treat them with diazepam. If they are above the neonate age, the neonatal period, the drug of choice that we start off with is diazepam. If they're a neonate, the drug of choice we start off with when treating seizures is your phenobarb. Okay, take note of that. Now, station 31, where I'd realized that the stream had actually cut off here. So what signs can you see? What other signs would you look for? What is the most likely diagnosis? Mention four possible complications of your diagnosis. What is the long-term management? So this is one way in which they can bring the question. Another way in which they can bring the question is that they can be bossing of the so this is known as bossing, the prominence of the forehead, and they can sometimes bring a child that is jaundiced eyes. So now I want you to pay close attention, very much close attention. You thank me later. Pay close attention as to why this child has frontal bossing. Remember that this patients with sickle cell, their red blood cells are being hemolyzed, and there's supposed to be some compensatory mechanism that's there. So in the remember that in as the children grow older, synthesis of red blood cells is just limited to the bones of the axial skeleton, the ones that are in the midline, as well as the proximal ends of the long bones. So most of the times there's going to be what is known as accentuation. Accentuation meaning that it's over proliferating. Accentuation, or it's becoming more prominent. Accentuation of the trabeculae. The trabeculae are what you find in the skull bones. So you have accentuation of the trabeculae as a result of compensatory hyperplasia. That's why we get frontal bossing in sickle cell. Okay, I'll say that again. Accentuation of the trabeculae with compensatory hyperplasia. Of course, the jaundice is a result of hemolysis. Now, what other signs would we look for? So they may be jaundice, there may be swollen, painful joints, there may be pallor. It's very difficult to sometimes see if there's deep jaundice with pallor. It's very difficult to see that. And of course, what is the most likely diagnosis? So this is sickle cell anemia. What are the four possible complications? They could have the crisis, the splenic sequestration, the hyperhemolytic crisis, the aplastic crisis, the vaso-occlusive crisis. They could sometimes even have chronic leg ulcers. The long-term management is to put them on folate, one to cover them on malaria prophylaxis. Remember that they can fend off Plasmodium falciparum, which is the most severe form of malaria, but the other species, they are susceptible. They can actually get the other species. So when they get malaria, it even does them much, much worse than before. Then, of course, give them a pneumococcal vaccine as well. Station 32, what do you see? Give four differentials, write down four investigations you would do, list down two complications due to this condition. So this again is a something similar that we saw earlier on. So clubbing of the fingers, cyanosis, most likely a cyanotic heart, congenital heart disease. They begin with T's, X-ray, echocardiograph, ECG, even FBC are important. Complications, you could have thromboembolic phenomenon, endocarditis, even sudden cardiac death or sudden death. Now, station 33. What are the abnormalities? What is your diagnosis? List five essential steps of care. What advice would you give this patient's mother to avoid a similar condition in the next siblings? So this here you should have seen on my channel if you follow my channel very well. This, as you can see, there is wasting of this child. How do I know that there is wasting? Prominence of the ribs. As you can see, prominence of the bones. Okay. Then we have ascites. So this is a swollen abdomen. You can say distended abdomen if you don't want to commit to saying ascites. Pedoedema. Bulging, temporal bulging. Okay. There's some hair loss in this area. So this child has severe acute malnutrition. I don't want to commit and say, you can say either kwashioka or marasmus, because it's more of, they're more on a spectrum. Moreover, the management is largely the same, whether it's a child that's coming with kwashioka, a child that's coming with marasmus, the management is largely the same. So that's why we want to use the diagnosis of severe acute malnutrition. So the five steps, remember, we treat and prevent hypoglycemia, treat and prevent hypothermia, treat and prevent infections, rehydrate and control electrolyte imbalances, of course, micronutrients and feeding. Also, remember those 10 steps of malnutrition, management of malnutrition. So you want to give the mother nutritional advice. It's not just about quantity, but quality of the food. You also want to monitor the growth of the child, immunize the child, offer family planning. Because remember, sometimes it's in the bracket of someone coming in from the huge family. With this economy and the way the fuel prices are increasing, and you have 10 children, you feel the impact. No matter how rich you are, you feel the impact. And again, there are some families that tend to eat together you get a chow that eats very quickly. You have those that eat very slowly. So you get those discrepancies in the amount of calories and the proteins that are being taken by this child. Here's another picture that could show up as a sickle cell case. So remember, sickle cell can present in many ways. They can, I've given you four different ways in which they can question on you on the exam. Keep those in mind. So here is another characteristic feature. So this is known as a hair on end appearance. The diagnosis is most likely sickle cell anemia. We can see this hair on end appearance on the, what do you call this, hemolytic conditions. It's also due to accentuation of the trabeculae. This hair on end appearance due to accentuation of the trabeculae. Okay, station 35, name the species 1 to 3, list two clinical features and the diseases caused by the species 1 and 2, mention one risk factor for 2, what is the drug of choice in the treatment of this condition? So again, this is one of those things, if you have seen it before, you would know what it is. If you haven't seen it before, you have no idea what it is. So these are eggs of schistosoma, okay? So this is schistosoma Mansoni, okay? Schistosoma hematobium. How I remember hematobium is that the T in hematobium should help you remember that it has a terminal spine. T for terminal spine. That's how I remember that. This is a hematobium. Then this is Mansoni. It has a lateral spine. This is a lateral spine. Then of course, this one here is japonicum. It's not so common. So the two that are common, 1 and 2. Okay, so this is going to be causing intestinal schistosomiasis. That's with 1. Then you may have bloody diarrhea, you may have ascites, you may have splenomegaly. Then your specimen 2 is pretty much going to be your urinary schistosomiasis, where you have this painless terminal hematuria. You may also have your frequency. Now the risk factor of developing the 2, your urinary schistosomiasis, is pretty much swimming in or walking barefoot in water that are containing the Sicaria for your pretty much your schistosome. Then of course your drug of choice is your praziquantel. So here's an alternate image of these things. These are all having lateral spines. So these are schistosoma Mansoni. Station 36, which is another common thing that you may have come across as you are rotating in pediatrics. So what is the most likely diagnosis? What investigations would you order and what would you see? What other investigations would you order? How would you treat this child? What is the main complication of treatment associated with this disorder, metabolic disorders? And then how would you prevent this complication? So this is of course swelling of the jaw. As you can see, this is swelling of the jaw. It's even necrotic here to some extent. This is characteristically seen in Burkitt's lymphoma. So you get a biopsy, and on the biopsy, this is what is characteristic that you see on Burkitt's lymphoma. It's referred to as a starry sky appearance. After this stream, I want you to go on Google and I want you to note this down and search up a starry sky appearance. We'll be done with the stream very, very soon. In about 30 minutes, this stream will be done. So there'll be a starry sky appearance. Google that and see what it looks like on histology. Sometimes they do bring you that on your exams. So you want to do a full blood count. You want to do your liver function tests. You want to do your creatinine. You want to do your cross match. You also want to order a CT scan. Of course, the CT scan is for staging of the disease. Chemotherapy is important, and remember the complication that we talked about is tumor lysis syndrome. You may have hypocalcemia, hyperuricemia, hyperkalemia, and hyperphosphatemia. Those are the entities that you are looking out for in tumor lysis syndrome. Of course, we prevent this complication by rehydrating them before chemotherapy and giving them allopurinol, as I already mentioned in that case that we looked about with leukemia. Here's another station 37. Study the image and answer the following questions. What are your findings? What is the diagnosis? What are some complications associated with this condition? List 4 associated risk factors of this condition. So as you can see, this child here has an opening in their palate. Okay, so this is an opening in the palate, especially on the right. This is known as a cleft palate. So they may have feeding problems. They may have speech problems. For you to be able to speak, your sinuses need to be okay. The cavities in the mouth need to be completely closed, as in there shouldn't be any any opening or any communication to the nasopharynx, so for the vocalization of the voice. And of course, you may also have some hearing problems. You may have some frequent ear infections, because remember that the ear and the nose are connected. They're connected. So there's going to be a connection with the oropharynx as well as getting into the nasopharynx. So there may be some manifestation. So will I post the video? Yes. I'm not sure though if the whole video will be there, because the stream was a point where the stream cut, but I will try and see if I can get it out. Then list four associated risk factors of this condition. So smoking during pregnancy, diabetes, obesity, increasing maternal age, some medications, especially the anti-epileptic drugs. They tend to cause your cleft palate. Then station 38, interpret the hemogram of a 9-year-old boy, list the abnormalities and what is the diagnosis. White blood cell count is 3.5, RBC is 4.3, HB is 8.5, MCV is 61, MCHC is 24.3, MCHC is 30.8, a platelet count is 180. So this is I think, a very, very manageable station. So most likely this child has a low HB. They have a low mean corpuscular volume. They have a low MCHC and they have a low MCH. So the diagnosis here will be your microcytic hypochromic anemia. Most likely in this child, if we're looking at our setting, the most common cause of microcytic anemia in developing countries is iron deficiency, most commonly caused by infections, with worm infestations being one of the major causes. Now, station 39, a urinalysis of a 18-year-old baby shows that the color is pale yellow. There are 7 to 9 pus cells. The urine is slightly turbid. The RBC is 1 to 2. Bilirubin is nil. Epithelial cells are occasional. Urobilinogen is normal. Yeast cells, nil. Protein 1+. Crystals, nil. The ketones are negative. Casts are negative. Leukocytes 2+. Blood or glucose is negative. A pH is 5. It's specific gravity 1.02. So write down three possible ways of collecting urine from this child. Remember, keep in mind, this is an 18-month baby. What is the most likely organism on the culture? Write down three clinical features associated with this condition. What is significant bacteriuria? So this child already, we can establish that they have a UTI, a urinary tract infection. How do I know this? The leukocytes in the urine, the pus cells in the urine, the appearance of the urine is slightly turbid. So how do we collect urine from this child? There are three ways. So we can collect using a urine bag, okay? So it looks like a plastic that has an end that can stick on the child, and you just simply stick it on the genitalia of the child. It's not recommended if you're trying to make a diagnosis of UTIs. Sometimes you may use a urinary catheter. They are very, very small. If you have ever seen a urinary catheter for pediatrics, then you would know what I'm talking about. They're quite small. You may sometimes use a urinary catheter. Then you may perform what is known as a suprapubic, not supraoibic. I don't know what this is. Suprapubic aspirate, where you now feel for the bladder. And then, of course, you go through the suprapubic area. This is, of course, the cleanest way. But, of course, the challenge is that if the bladder is not full, you won't be able to feel for the bladder above the pubic bone. And, of course, when you're doing your collecting urine, you should have a clean catch, a midstream clean catch. So this takes a lot of time and it's very tedious. Then the likely organisms are going to be your E. coli, your proteas, your pseudomonas, and even Klebsiella. Then the three clinical features that may be associated with this, they may have a fever, they may have lethargy, they may have a neonatal jaundice, they may have irritability, and significant bacteriuria. For you to say that someone has a UTI, from your culture, you need at least more than 10 to the power 5 colonies per mil of the urine in a pure culture that you have collected without any symptoms. But then if they, I mean, with symptoms, that's a UTI. If they don't have any symptoms, then you just simply call that as significant bacteriuria. Now, question 40, a patient presents with excessive thirst. What questions would you ask to arrive to a possible diagnosis? What is your differential diagnosis? List two important investigations you would request for. So again, someone has presented with thirst. It's very, very important. Very important that you actually ask about questions that are related to your cause. So you're thinking, could this be DKA? I mean, rather diabetes. I don't know why I have DKA in my mind. Or could this be diabetes mellitus? Could this be diabetes insipidus? What's the difference between the two conditions? Diabetes mellitus is a carbohydrate disorder. Most of us know what it is, where you either are not producing insulin at all, or you're producing insulin, but the insulin receptor is not responding to the insulin. So there's some form of insulin resistance. Diabetes insipidus, on the other hand, is a problem to do with ADH. You have two types of diabetes insipidus. You have what is known as the central diabetes insipidus, where there is a problem with your production of ADH from the hypothalamus and it being released from the pituitary gland. There's a problem with that. You're not producing it. You're not releasing it. Or you have what is known as your peripheral, or it's known as your nephrogenic diabetes insipidus, where you're producing the ADH, but your kidneys are not really responding to the ADH. So you're going to be asking questions that are in relation to this. The age of the patient, we are not yet told that. The duration of the excessive thirst. If they have any other associated symptoms like weight loss, weight gain, excessive urination, nocturia, or enuresis, which is bedwetting, excessive eating, fainting, and even dysuria, and even hematuria. Ask also if there's a history of diabetes in the child, or if there's a history of diabetes in the family. Now, of course, two important investigations in a urinalysis is important. Your serum glucose, your urine electrolytes, and creatinine. Now you ask me, how would you differentiate between diabetes insipidus and diabetes mellitus on a urinalysis? Very simple. If they had diabetes mellitus, they will have glucose in their urine. You won't see that's this in diabetes insipidus. That's the first thing. The second thing is, of course, your urine electrolytes. Remember that the concentration of sodium in someone who has diabetes mellitus may be low, okay? Why it may be low, or it may actually be normal. Why? It's because this patients in diabetes mellitus, they tend to lose a lot of fluids, so they'll have an ADH response where they produce a lot of ADH that's supposed to reabsorb the sodium and supposed to reabsorb the water, ADH and aldosterone, through the renin-angiotensin system. Now, on the other hand, with the diabetes insipidus, with the diabetes insipidus, you're not producing the ADH, or the ADH is not responding to the kidneys. So whatever may happen, whether they're losing, they'll keep losing the sodium in the urine. So they'll have a higher concentration of sodium in the urine. Here's another video that I want to play for you, and I want you to watch. I want you to watch this video very, very closely. This video is quite long. Anyways, I think you've gotten the gist of what is happening here. So you're watching the video very closely. So as you're watching the video, think of the questions. What are your findings? What is your diagnosis? List 4 risk factors. List 2 features you would see on abdominal x-ray that would be indicative of this condition. So as you can see, this child is in some considerable respiratory distress. That's the first thing that is there. The features of respiratory distress. So there's use of accessory muscles of respiration. There are intercostal recessions. The abdomen is distended. Okay, it's quite distended in this child. As you can see, it's appearing discolored. There are some visible veins that you can see on the abdomen. This is very, very characteristic of necrotizing enterocolitis. The risk factors, prematurity is a very big thing. Infections, especially with Clostridium species, very big thing. Sepsis, hypoxia, early feedings, or even when you feed someone with hypertonic milk, or even excessive fluids, even HIE have been implicated as some causes that are going to be causing necrotizing enterocolitis. Now, the two features that you would see on the x-ray, you can sometimes have air in the walls. I think someone asked about pneumatosis intestinalis earlier on the stream. So you may see pneumatosis intestinalis, you may see air fluid levels, you may see gas in the portal system or the portal venous system. You may sometimes see a pneumoperitoneum. That's because of a perforation, so air under the diaphragm. Okay, so that's the presentation. Anyways, moving on to the next station, station 43. A baby born at 28 weeks is brought to the NICU. What questions would you ask in the history? What are the risk factors for preterm birth? What investigations would you do? How would you manage this child? So this is basically prematurity. They're just even giving you the answer on the plate. So this is pretty much a prematurity. So the risk factors of prematurity could be the maternal age, multiple pregnancies, infections like chorioamnionitis, maternal illnesses like hypertension in pregnancy that may cause this woman to deliver earlier than normal. Of course, there may be, you also want to ask about the obstetric history. You want to ask, what was the condition of this child at birth? Did they cry? What was the APGA score? Did they need to be resuscitated? Then, of course, the birth weight is very important. If any steroids or any magnesium sulfate was given to the mother before her giving birth. Then the risk factors for preterm birth, of course, can be divided as maternal or fetal. Maternal factors include diseases that affect the mother during pregnancy, preeclampsia, group B streptococcal infections, chronic medical illnesses, previous preterm delivery. It could sometimes be some uterine pathologies or placental abnormalities like placenta previa, placenta abruption, premature rupture of membranes, polyhydramnios, even cervical incompetence. Then, of course, it could be sometimes some fetal problems, which could be things like a multiple gestation. You could sometimes have some congenital anomalies. Then investigations that you want to do: a full blood count to rule out, of course, sepsis, a blood culture, of course, to rule out infections, urea, electrolytes and creatinine, liver function test, urinalysis, and of course your urine microscopy calcium sensitivity, just to screen this child. Then you want to admit them to the NICU. They're already admitted. Temperature control, put them in an incubator, because premature children, their skin is not, even their hypothalamic centers that control temperature is not as developed. So you want to put them in an incubator. Then, of course, total parenteral nutrition, because there's a risk of them developing necrotizing enterocolitis. Cover them on antibiotics, pretty much your cefotaxime and your cloxacillin, your vitamin K, 1 milligram IM. Then, of course, you treat any complications that arise. An alternative thing that they can bring you, and I want you to pay close attention. Sometimes they may not even give you this story of, no, this mother was at 20 what weeks when they gave birth, or the child was admitted. They may just give you this picture. Okay, and they'll ask you, what is the striking feature that is seen in this picture that is shown on your screen here? So as you can see here, this child has this hair here, this characteristic here, even on the forehead here. You refer to this as lanugo. Okay, it's a primitive kind of hair that's supposed to fall off as the child is reaching term and the child has reached term. So they may sometimes show you a child that has lanugo. Keep it in mind that they are just simply referring to prematurity. Station 44, look at the hands of this patient. Describe the abnormality or abnormality seen. What is the most common pathology which causes these or this clinical sign in Zambia? How would you investigate and treat? So this is relative. You can see that the child's palm here is much, much pale as compared to the palm of the person underneath. So this is palmar pallor. The most common causes is either hookworm infestation or malaria. Okay, so doc, the video going up to station number what? Okay, we're almost done. There's only, I think, it's up to station 60. That's the last station. 60 is the last station, so we're almost done. Then how would you investigate this patient? So pretty much your RDT for malaria or malaria parasite slide, a sickling test, your stool for occult blood, your stool for ova in parasites. And of course, we treat them with antihelminthic agents. If it's hookworm infestation, if it's malaria, you can use your artemether and lumefantrine, which is your coartem, for uncomplicated cases. And then for complicated cases, we can use your artesunate. Here's another video that I want you to pay close attention to. Okay, so as you're watching the video, what signs do you see? What is your diagnosis? List 6 causes. How would you treat? Okay, as you can see, this child is making some mouth movements. There's even some boxing that is inside there. So this child has some lip smirking, there's some chewing like movements even that they're making here. And then I'll show you where the boxing is. He's boxing like this here. It's more of even a cycling movements here. You can see they're lifting up both of these. They've been trying, there's some cycling there that's put in. So this is a neonatal seizure. So the causes could be metabolic, so hypoglycemia, hypomagnesemia, hypocalcemia, hypo or hypernatremia. There could be developmental malformations. It could also be infections like meningitis. So how do we treat? Remember, this is a neonate. So we're going to be treating the hypoglycemia if there's any. We abort the seizures using our phenobarb. So 20 milligrams per kg IV infusion over 10 minutes. And then we can repeat if the seizures actually do persist. So I want you to keep this in mind. Moving on to station 47, these are the blood results of a 9-year-old boy with query pneumonia, fast breathing, and dehydration. So you have your sodium as 128, your potassium as 2.4, your urea as 7.2, your creatinine as 9.4, and your glucose is 24. Identify the abnormalities. What is the diagnosis? Why is he breathing fast? So this child has a low sodium concentration. They have a low potassium and they have a quite high glucose, so most likely this child is a DKA that was triggered by a pneumonia. So it's a DKA with a pneumonia. The reason why he's breathing fast is because it has a response of the acidosis. Remember, the more carbon dioxide, the body thinks of it like this: if you have anything that's going wrong with the pH of the blood, whether it's a metabolic acidosis or metabolic alkalosis, the compensation is going to be coming from the respiratory system. So it means that if someone has a metabolic acidosis, they are going to now increase their respiratory rate because they are trying to blow off that carbon dioxide and reduce the, or rather increase the pH of the blood. So that's why. Or another reason is that it could be due to the pneumonia itself, because pneumonia also causes tachypnea. Okay, station 49. Study the video and answer the questions that follow. So yet another video here. Okay, so now here I want you to pay very, very close attention, especially towards the end of the video. Pay close attention. Okay, pay close attention. Keep paying close attention to the video. Okay, so that's the video, pretty much. So as you notice from the video, what is very apparent in this is that this child has some intercostal recessions. They also have some substernal and subcostal recessions. So they're in some form of distress. But if you watch the video at the end, when the person who's capturing the video actually presses on the nose of the child, you can even see that there is some jaundice that actually is there. So most likely this child has some neonatal jaundice that could have been caused by a neonatal sepsis, if I'm presuming. So it could be caused by pneumonia, it could be caused by sepsis, prematurity, even recess isomerization could be a cause of this. So keep this in mind. Now, one last thing on jaundice that I want you to look up for, and please write this down, look up the Kramer staging, k-r-a-m-e-r. Please look up the Kramer staging and make sure you commit it to memory. Look up the Kramer stage in the different zones and the different levels of hyperbilirubinemia that are seen with the different zones. So station 50, describe what you see. What is your diagnosis? What indicators confirm the diagnosis? What are the three phases of management? Okay, so these are features of severe wasting. There's also loss of subcutaneous fat around the cheeks, as you can see here. This child also has a characteristic old man face, but we don't want to refer to it as that. So this child has severe acute malnutrition. And of course, the features that would indicators of this would be a weight for height less than -3 st, your MUAC that's less than 11.5, if they have bilateral repeating edema, if they have severe visible wasting. And of course, the three phases are your number one, your stabilization phase, number two, your transition phase, and then your third phase is your rehabilitation and follow-up. Some people just divide them into three predominant phases, so pretty much your stabilization and your rehabilitation phase. Station 57, shown at the hands of a five-year-old boy. What do the images portray? What is the diagnosis? How does the disease come about? What complication of the presentation is in the hands? So again, sickle cell. Very important. This is like the fifth station on sickle cell, if I presume. So this child has frontal bossing. They also have dactylitis. This is sickle cell. So the condition is inherited. And the inheritance pattern is autosomal recessive, meaning that you, for someone to have the disease, they should either be a carrier, two carriers marrying each other, or a carrier marrying a person with sickle cell, that they get this condition. So this child has acute dactylitis, most likely secondary to a vaso-occlusive crisis. Okay, here is another video that I want you to watch. So this is a two-day-old neonate. Okay. So describe what you see. What is your diagnosis? Mention any four causes of your condition. If this is due to an infectious cause, mention any two long-term complications. So this child is almost similar to that video that I showed you earlier on, where they're making this automatic movements, the blinking and the chewing movements. So this is a neonatal convulsion. So it's caused by neonatal sepsis or meningitis, hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, hypoglycemia, electrolyte imbalances, even intravenous malformations. Now, if it's infectious causes that are causing this, it can lead to hydrocephalus, it can lead to epilepsy, it can also lead to cerebral palsy. Now, here's another station that you're familiar with. This is a picture of a nine-year-old child recently diagnosed with HIV. On examination, her right lower limb is edematous, but non-pitting. Okay, so this is unilateral swelling. What is your diagnosis? Assign a WHO staging to this condition. How would you confirm your diagnosis? So this, I think I've shown before. It's an African lymphadenopathic Kaposi sarcoma. Or you can just say Kaposi sarcoma. If you're in seventh year, I'd expect you to say African lymphadenopathic Kaposi sarcoma. If you're in fifth year, Kaposi sarcoma will just be enough to get you the marks. It's a tumor. If it's an HIV, you find this at stage 4. How you confirm this? You get a skin biopsy. You see three things. Spindle-shaped cells, extravasated red blood cells, and prominent slit-like vascular spaces. Now here's the other presentation, the sixth slide on sickle cell. If you haven't read on sickle cell, please, I beg you, go read. Okay, so this is an HB electrophoresis result that was done. As you can see here, 7% of HBF, 0% of HBA, and sickle cell hemoglobin is 93, so this should be 0. So identify the investigation shown on the right. What is the diagnosis? Give four clinical features of this condition. What is the inheritance pattern? Again, this is HB electrophoresis. It's sickle cell anemia in this case, not sickle cell disease. You should sickle cell anemia. Okay. Then the four clinical features, it could be frontal bossing, painful symmetrical swelling of the digits and the toes, recurrent abdominal and even back pains, even jaundice. Of course, it's an autosomal recessive inheritance pattern. Then station 55, describe what you see in the picture. You give two risk factors of this condition. Name four short-term complications related to this condition. Write down two long-term complications due to this condition. So as you can see, this child is quite small. So this is a very small sized neonate, and skin is rather thin. The risk factors: maternal gestational diabetes, preeclampsia, placenta previa, premature rupture of membranes, polyhydramnios, seven multiple gestations. The four short-term complications that are going to be related to this complication, or rather to this condition, are things like hypoglycemia, respiratory distress syndrome, necrotizing enterocolitis, hypothermia, fluid and electrolyte imbalances, even intraventricular hemorrhage. Most likely this child was a preemie, a premature child. So two long-term complications are, for example, rickets of prematurity, blindness, learning disabilities, cerebral palsy, retinopathy of prematurity, and even some hearing impairments. Here's another thing that you should have seen on your WADS if you were rotating at UTH, or if you are rotating at UTH, if you're at Levy, if the nutrition has come, sometimes they do come with this thing. So if you are very inquisitive, you may have seen this thing. So name the item shown on the right. What is it used for? State the range to determine the worst degree of your answer to question B. Write two other ways of assessing this condition in question B. So this is known as a Shakir tape or a MUAC tape, okay? It's used for measuring the mid-upper arm circumference to make a diagnosis of severe acute malnutrition. If they have a MUAC that's less than 11.5 centimeter, that's diagnostic. Other ways that you can use anthropometrics. You can use your weight for height Z-scores. You can use your tricep skin fold thickness. And of course, clinical features such as wasting as well as a pedoedema. So keep this in mind, please. Here's another thing that you should have come across. I'll be shocked, very shocked, if you have never seen this at all in your life. So this is an under 5 cut. So besides growth monitoring, name the three activities that are usually carried out in the relevant clinic, the under 5 clinic. Give three live attenuated vaccines that are given. So please make sure that you go through my video that I did on immunizations and vaccines and the different vaccines that we give at the different times. It's very helpful. And then outline the schedule of visits to the clinic in the under 5 Zambia immunization program. Then which one is absolutely contraindicated in symptomatic HIV? So we do immunization at under 5. We give vitamin A supplementation, though most of the vitamin A now is present in the sugar. We perform HIV testing. We also deworm the children. We also provide nutritional health education. So the live attenuated vaccines that are given is BCG, your bacillus calmatile guarin vaccine, measles, and rubella. And this is how it's given. The first vaccines are given at birth, okay? Or within the first 13 days of the child being born. So you give them two vaccines. You give them BCG. You give them OPV0. OPV0, you may actually skip it. If it's skipped, it's okay. You can give it later on. Then the child rests. Then they come back after 6 weeks. So at 6 weeks, you give OPV1, diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus, hepatitis B and Haemophilus influenza type B, as well as PCV and rotavirus 1. Then there's 4 weeks in between. So the next one, it means that you give it at 10 weeks. So at 10 weeks, you give OPV2 or those same vaccines that I mentioned, the second dose. Then at the third dose is again for 4 weeks later, so at week 14. So now here, take note that OPV3 is given with IPV, okay? It's given with IPV. That's the injected polio vaccine. Then, of course, the other dosage for diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus, your hepatitis B and Haemophilus influenza B, as well as PCV3. Then at 9 months and 18 months, we give measles and rubella. At 9 months, if they didn't receive the OPV3, they can also receive the OPV4. If they didn't receive OPV0 at birth. So the live attenuated vaccines are not given in symptomatic HIV patients because they have the propensity to cause disease, especially with measles. So you can also have this with BCG and rubella, but more with measles. Question 58, an 11 month old girl presents with severe malnutrition. What is the diagnosis? What important disease would you ask about in the history? What micronutrient is lacking in this child? How would you manage this condition? What is the possible complication? Okay, so and here's the picture that is shown on the screen. So this is a corneal opacity. Okay, it's not really a bite or spot. Actually, in retrospect, this looks like a bite or spot here. If you can see this here. This looks like a bite. This whitish appearance here is a bite or spot, or bit or spot, however you want to pronounce it. Okay, but they have a corneal opacity. So this is obviously you would want to ask about history of measles. You want to ask about history of malnutrition. the micronutrient that is lacking in this child is, of course, vitamin A. And this is how we give it. If it's an infant between 0 to 5 months, if they're less than 6 months, we give 50,000 international units. If they are between 6 to 12 months, we give 100,000 international units. If they are greater than 1 year, we give 200,000 international units. So this child is 11 months. So it means that we're going to be giving 100,000 international units. But if this child now has this eye manifestation, you give it the day that they report, that's day zero, you give it on day two, and you give it on day 14, okay? And if the child is greater than 1 year, but they're weighing less than 8 kg, then you should give them 100,000 international units. So the complication of this is that the cornea can perforate. They can sometimes also become blind. The second last station, a 3-year-old girl presents with history of diarrhea and vomiting, and she is lethargic. What is this sign that is shown on your screen? What other signs would you look for? What is the level of dehydration? How would you treat the dehydration? Again, these are topics that you can't afford to walk into an Osce station or a pediatric exam without knowing. Dehydration, then you'll be cheating yourself. So this is, of course, poor skin tagger. They may have depressed fontanelle, but in this case, this is a 3-year-old, so we can actually scrape that out, remove the depressed fontanelle. So they may have sunken eyes, dry mucous membranes, delayed capillary refill time. And of course, they have features of severe dehydration. You use your Plan C, WHO. So 100 milligrams per kg of either Ringer's lactate or half-strength diarrheal solution. So 30 mils per kg to run in 30 minutes because this child is greater than a year. And 70 mils per kg to run in 2 hours, 30 minutes. And then, of course, after the child is rehydrated, the adjuvant that you give is the zinc sulfate. Now, the last and indeed final station before we conclude this stream, an 8-month-old baby presents to the hospital like this, shown in the picture. It's like as if it's being demon possessed. What is the sign? What is your diagnosis? What other signs would you look for in this child? What investigation would you do to confirm your diagnosis? What are some of the complications? So this arching of the back is referred to as opisthotonus. Okay, opisthotonus. It's seen in generalized tetanus. So the other signs that you may see is what is known as rhesus sardonicus, where they have this characteristic grin because their teeth are locked together, okay? Then you may sometimes do a spatula test, which may be positive, where you get a spatula. Just by touching the posterior pharyngeal wall, you stimulate the muscles, and then the jaws will contract involuntarily, and this will cause the child to hold on to the spatula with the teeth. So if it's negative, they'll get a gag reflex if it's negative. Then, of course, you want to do a lumbar puncture. You have an increase in opening pressure due to the spasms. You also order for serum muscle enzymes, creatinine kinase, and aldolase, because this sometimes causes muscle damage. And you get these are elevated. You also order for a serum antitoxin levels, because the tetanus is going to be producing toxins. That's your Clostridium tetani, which is causing this. Complications include aspiration pneumonias, long bone fractures, pulmonary embolisms, malnutrition, urinary retention. You may even have shoulder and temporomandibular dislocations that may be there. Now, before we end the stream, I just want to leave a few questions on your mind that you should attempt. I will post this PowerPoint presentation to my Dropbox, and I'll put a link in the comments. I also put a link on my community tab where you can actually download this presentation and have a look at this question. So there are 6 questions that I want you to have a look at. You can discuss with your buddies, you can discuss before the exam, whatever you want. So here's the first question with a karyotype. Here's the second question. It's a rather an essay type of question. Another one which is an essay type of question. Here's one where there's a picture. Here there's also another heart defect that I want you to have a look at and discuss with your buddies whenever you are going to discuss. And then here's one with the vertebra. Okay, I want you to discuss. And possibly if you can comment the answers in the comment section, and I'll pretty much check through them and give you some feedback on them. Then, of course, the last and final station is this, a chest x-ray. It's never really a medical exam if you don't get a chest x-ray. So these are the questions that are there in the PowerPoint presentation. I will post the PowerPoint presentation just after this stream, so keep a lookout for that. Come back to the video, check my community tab. Those that have my contacts, you can check my status. I will post the link there. I'll post everything there, and those that are even on the different groups, I will post them on each of the different groups. And going into your OSCE stations, just some general advice. As I told the others that were on the stream for internal medicine yesterday, please breathe when you're answering your questions. Breathe, calm yourself, take a deep breath. Read the entire question first before you start to attempt the question. You may read and you think it's something, you reach station six and you realize, oh, this is something else. You cancel, already 3 minutes has gone. Read through the entire question first. Get perspective of what the examiner wants of you, where the examiner is leading you towards. And then always put as much detail as possible. Do not leave anything to chance. Do not assume, never write abbreviations. And I wish you the best. If you haven't subscribed to the channel, please subscribe to the channel. Drop a like before you leave the stream. I know you guys have been quite so much fun commenting, and I've enjoyed this stream, and I wish to see you in more such future streams. Tell other people to subscribe to the channel. All the best in your exam tomorrow. Until next time, my name is Dr. Moses Kazevu, to Zambia and beyond. Bye-bye.